Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us on this Wednesday, the 14th day of September 2016. All hell has broken loose for the New World Order, kicking off on September 11th. They were launching so many of their big plans this month to openly bring in the world government, to incrementally bring in the global financial collapse, and to basically crown it off with their global cashless society. But Hillary Clinton really historically collapsed, obviously, while leaving ground zero unexpectedly. And a domino effect of other cover-ups are just collapsing down right now. If you go to drudgereport.com, what the New York Times even admits is the most coveted spot in the media, is the large banner black headline daily. He said, "What? Colin Powell hellstorm." And that is a Mikhail Thalen article from Infowars.com dealing with the fact that Colin Powell talked about the fact with Democratic donors, because he's basically a Democrat, high-level Democratic donors, that Hillary Clinton could not walk up the stairs to the podium last year. So massive developments unfolding on that front. It's well known that Hillary's been seriously ill. It's well known she was in the hospital for a year in 2012 and 13. It's well known that she has medical personnel running along beside her with EpiPens for convulsions. It's well known that her situation is deteriorating. And now former Secret Service agents are coming out and saying, yes, she's having seizures. So over a month ago, we told you that we talked to the Secret Service, and they said, look, she's falling down more and more. Her situation is deteriorating. But here it is, the hacked emails. A lot of other media is focusing in on other areas of the Colin Powell hacked emails that are obviously a treasure trove. Colin Powell's personal email hacked under pressure to endorse Hillary Clinton. In fact, they're in the email saying, endorse us and we'll stop saying, hey, look, you had emails that should have been secret. Now, the difference is they hadn't passed those laws yet when Colin Powell was in. And I by no means am defending Colin Powell. The point is Hillary lied about it, deleted 33,000 emails, and it's what's in the emails. In Colin Powell's emails is stuff about Hillary Clinton being sick. In Hillary's emails, it's selling access to the Chinese president and selling access to the State Department, totally illegal. That's the issue. There's a lot of other orbiting points, but the large planetary issue is that she could barely climb the podium steps, three steps. Hillary Clinton is seriously ill. And then continuing, ladies and gentlemen, we have big news. One of Putin's best friends, they say, in Russia was appointed 3 years ago to head up state-run Russian television. And he has come out, so basically the mouth of Putin has come out and said that the state is basically really worried about the globalists killing Donald Trump, which is obviously a common sense statement. It's a very powerful video. No one has an English translation of it other than subtitles, and it's not even the full translation. So we had one. We aired it in the fourth hour yesterday. We're going to be airing that again coming up at the start of the next segment. So stay with us. I'm Alex Jones. The websites are Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. We've got a bunch of big guests today. Mark Dice has done it again. It was first circulating online, but now he went out and tested it with Californians. The majority of them, well, actually none of them got it. They all believe that the Trumps are hunting and killing extinct dinosaurs like pterodactyls and triceratops. Stay with us.
The cult of Hillary was called in to answer for their privatized investigation into the Clinton email server debacle. Facing the Oversight and Government Reform Committee, spokespersons for the DOJ, the State Department, the FBI, the Department of National Intelligence, the CIA, the Geospatial Intelligence Agency, and the NSA faced a frustrated Congress that had been given the cold shoulder when it came to the sharing of key details of Hillary Clinton's endangerment of U.S. national security.
And for some of you, I had to threaten to send a subpoena just to get you to appear today. We did some math. We got 70 of you sitting here. Between your compensation and your benefits package, you make more than $1 million from taxpayers. Taxpayers are paying you seven more than $1 million. And you won't even come talk to Congress. What do you do all day if you don't talk to Congress? What is it that you believe we don't have the right to see? See, this is the way our government works. We get to do oversight. That's why since 1814, this committee has been doing that. There's executive privilege. Let me help you. There's executive privilege. Has the president invoked executive privilege in this case?
No.
The answer is no. Good. That's right. The answer is no. Is there any other situation?
Look, when it comes to classified information and the classification that deals in the executive order, you know, not all the information that we have in our files belongs to us. We defer to other agencies when it comes to access to their classified information.
But you are the ones that put redactions on personal identifiable information, correct?
We did on the personal identifiable information. That's correct.
Where in the Constitution does it say that I can't see that?
It doesn't address it specifically in the Constitution.
Here's the problem. You handpicked the 302s to give to us, but the reality is you should give us all the 302s.
So let me say this. I think the director made principal decisions about what to say to Congress when he was here and also what to provide to Congress. As far as the
wait, where do I find that?
Personally identified.
Do we just let everybody in government decide that they're based on their own individual principles? That's what Congress... See, it's trust but verify is how it works. You don't get to decide what I get to see. I get to see it all. Will the FBI provide to Congress the full file with no redactions of personal identifiable information?
I cannot make that commitment sitting here today.
Then I'm going to issue a subpoena, and I'm going to do it right now. So let's go. I've signed this subpoena. We want all the 302s, and we would like the full file. You can accept service on behalf of the FBI?
Certainly.
You are hereby served.
You understand why Congress might want to know whether or not the attorney-client privilege was waived and who the client was?
I can certainly imagine.
Yeah, me too. That's why we want to see the file, Agent. I mean, you say it's unprecedented. Mr. Cummings used to be a criminal defense attorney. He got to see all your 302s. Ken Buck used to be an assistant United States attorney. He got to see all your 302s. Probation officers get to see all your 302s. Why can't Congress?
So I think we've given you the relevant ones as we...
Relevant according to whom? I am telling you, I don't think you've given me all the relevant 302s.
Well, the remainder of the 302s will come out through the FOIA process.
But since when did Congress have to go through FOIA?
Correct.
These mouthpieces betrayed the American people in full daylight, representing a decades-old shadow government that answers to a well-established network of global multinational corporations that view Congress and the American Constitution as meaningless. And that hubris is strong, as global government has just a few more building blocks to set before we are all under a legalized one-world government. Teddy Roosevelt once said, "Behind the ostensible government sits enthroned an invisible government owing no allegiance and acknowledging no responsibility to the people." John Bound for Infowars.com.
I wanted to air that special report that just came out today from John Bound because it's so powerful, and it reminds us that while we're looking at Hillary being caught lying about her serious health problems, and while we're looking at the latest hacked emails, and while we see Russian state TV worried that the globalist may kill Donald Trump, and while we see serious economic developments and the Kentucky governor urged to resign after saying blood will be shed if Hillary Clinton becomes president, that guy needs to be president now. We see all of this unfolding, all of this happening. Remember, we are hijacked and run by multinational banks. That's why every time they get exposed, they say Russia is supposedly running us, when Russia can barely stop from collapsing and is under globalist economic attack and paramilitary attack with asymmetrical warfare all across their borders. We are under attack by the very same New World Order as Russia. Does that mean Russia's perfect? No, but the globalists are a scientific evil, ladies and gentlemen. A scientific evil. I've got mainstream news articles here today. Motherless babies possible as scientists create live offspring without need for female egg. That's out of the London Telegraph. Here's another one. Astonishing self-driving Uber cars hit the road and will take over within 5 years. Their words, not ours. This is a total overwrite of the planet, not just humanity. You are living in 2016. The social engineers have basically suppressed the Renaissance, only given themselves the fruits of it. They're in basically 2050. They're already in the future, technically. And they're getting ready to mop up this reality. Their words, not mine. And people need to understand this. And here's the good news. Humanity is waking up. Humanity tends to wake up late in the game, but historically does tend to wake up. So we have huge news on Hillary's health front. It's the top story on DrudgeReport.com, the biggest story in the country. Hacked email, Colin Powell, Dem donor, worried over Clinton's health in 2015. They admit this is his email. This is him talking to a high-level Democratic donor. And he's saying, absolutely, I'm worried about her health. She couldn't even climb three stairs. She couldn't even get to the speech podium. We have it on screen for TV viewers, Infowars.com/show. Infowars.com/show. You can see the free video feed and on stations around the country. Back in 2015, Leeds and Powell discuss Hillary's health. Sheldon, White House, who is a huge Clinton supporter, say they were both giving speeches at the same event a few months back, and she could barely climb the podium. And then they discuss her health on after that. They all are in on it. They know she had brain surgery in 2012 and 13. We know she was in the hospital in those 2 years for more than a year total. Overlapping. We know she's falling down. The Secret Service told us a month ago, basically every 15, 20, 30 minutes. We're like, tell us more. And they're like, sometimes it's every hour. Sometimes it's every 15, 20 minutes. The point is, she has got something really bad. It's Parkinson's, brain tumor. We don't know. They won't tell us, but she is getting worse. And so Biggs said, because I let Biggs handle the source, well, what do we do? They said, go to her events. Watch the ambulance. Watch the handler. Watch the special system she uses to get in the vehicles. You're going to end up catching her collapsing. And on Monday, we came one micron from it with Millie Weaver and our crew in Cleveland, Ohio, last Monday, 9 days ago, where there's an ambulance, there's a medical gurney, a hospital bed, people in body armor. She's in a tent for 45 minutes, a small medical tent, comes out, has to cancel her speech, goes back in the medical tent. By the way, folks, you better understand the Secret Service are risking their lives bringing this type of information out. That in their entire history, they've never leaked information to the press like this because they understand this is not America they are serving. This is the globalist. This is the New World Order. These are the controllers. And then sure enough, 7 days later, 6 days later, she collapses. They've got the media held back. They don't tell the media she's leaving, but one of her supporters catches it on a smartphone, uploads it. Sells it. And so we see what the Secret Service told us was happening in Cleveland 2 months ago and what they told us again a month ago on camera, proven. Our credibility up, our credibility stratospheric, their credibility near zero. That's what this comes down to. That's how we defeat the New World Order. The problem is they're getting desperate. Now, I'm going to skip this network break because this is so important, and then we're going to get into mainstream media, admittedly, still getting talking points from Hillary on exactly what they're supposed to say. And we have mainstream media next to mainstream media saying the exact same words. We have incredible censorship taking place. And then we have the invincible ignorance of the very sad, pathetic, low-information voter that tends to get their news from mainstream media and who tends to support the Democratic Party. And I understand why. The Republican Party's been pretty darn bad, but compared to the Democrats, they don't hold a candle to them. To show their ignorance, later we are going to play a special report and have Mark Dice on, where there's been a meme on the internet the last few weeks of the Trump sons, Eric and Donald Jr., hunting big game. And the meme has been Triceratops, Tyrannosaurus Rex, pterodactyls, things that have been extinct for eons. 25 million years if you believe the paleontologist. And we couldn't find one Democrat voter on the streets of Southern California that didn't understand that it's impossible for the Trump sons to be out hunting extinct dinosaurs. And they even had politically correct answers, though. I mean, these people are really, really frightening. They're scary. They call us deplorable. They are deplorably ignorant, and I'm very, very sad for them. And I hope they'd wake up and discover the real world. This next story is incredibly important. It's up on Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. Drudge is also linked to this report. Putin appointed TV host. They may kill Donald Trump. And this is the man who runs Russia One, national radio and TV, official state-run media. This report is extremely important. It's up on Infowars.com, and we need to get this report out to everyone. Now, there's an earlier version that's only part of the translation up on the site right now. We have the full one you're about to see premiered here, translated into English with my introduction. That will be posted in the next 30 minutes or so. It's going up to YouTube and will be put in the article if you want to see it and hear it for yourself and share it with others. But this is what's going on in Russia, and our media is trying to blame Russia for everything right now, falsely, because they're globalist and they're the outsiders that have taken over, and they need to basically project what's really happening onto an outside country that doesn't have the power to do that. China actually is manipulating us to a great extent, Saudi Arabia and others. But when you talk about Russia, very, very little. And the reason this is so important, and the reason I'm really hammering on this right now, is because where's our media? Our media, the globalist media, covering this right now. You think they'd want to jump on top of it. The problem is you've got all these national talk show hosts and all these different New York Times writers, you name it, calling for the murder of Trump. So, see, they can't call this a conspiracy theory because they're the ones doing it. And then after the report, something even bigger. Here it is.
Longtime personal friend of Vladimir Putin, Dmitry Kiselyov, who was appointed in 2013 to run state-run media for Putin, came out and asked the question that many Americans are asking. With Trump ahead in the polls, with Hillary floundering and clearly having a medical crisis, will the establishment, the corrupt globalists that have hijacked America, kill Donald Trump? Now, this is really important because the individual saying this is basically the mouth of Vladimir Putin. So this is Vladimir Putin telling the American people, the Russian people, and the people of the world about their concerns for Donald Trump. And I think these concerns are extremely valid. Here is the report.
Two important pieces of news regarding Donald Trump. Number one, he's ahead in polls by 2 points. Number two, Trump declared that if he is president, he aims to have, quote, very good relations with Russia. This combination of Trump's characteristics, his leadership in the presidential race, his ability to speak boldly, his intentions to turn over a new leaf regarding the Russian-American relations, all this puts Trump in a very dangerous situation. Now they can just simply kill him. The intelligence services of the United States are not interested in the type of president Trump vows to be, because the contrived enemy in the form of Russia justifies their existence. American elites are not interested in a President Trump, as the establishment world order provides them with reliable sources of lucrative business. Trump, on the other hand, who is ready to reach agreements, would bring about a different set of financial opportunities flowing in other directions. The American establishment is merciless. Paul Craig Roberts, former Assistant Secretary of the Treasury for Economic Policy under President Reagan, has published a guest column on his website back in March by a journalist, Steven Lendman, who commented on what has become a very popular theme on social media websites. Quote, maybe an unfortunate plane crash, other fatal accident, or mysterious, incurable, fast-acting, deadly illness is planned. Will Trump be gone before Republicans choose their nominee in July, or perhaps before November's election? This narrative hasn't stopped, but the current state of the presidential race for Hillary Clinton is such where she has used up all of her available ammunition against Trump. She has an empty holder. Yet there are still almost 2 months to go until the election. She has already accused Trump of being a Putin agent, that he hates Muslims, Mexicans, and blacks, and his wife Melania is unworthy of the title of the First Lady, and that Trump himself is simply unfit, and that he's even deranged, and that he understands nothing in the way of the U.S. strategy, nor international affairs. And then he's a misogynist. Meanwhile, Trump details his plan of building relations with Russia, goes to Mexico, visits a popular black church, defends his wife's honor in court, and sees to his popularity among women. And the result? The scars put on Trump have nearly closed up, but the holes inflicted on Clinton are needing emergency surgery. Her carelessness with handling classified material while Secretary of State, foreign policy that led to terrorist expansion, her avarice and the questionable reputation of foreign donors to the Clinton Foundation, the dirty tricks of the Democratic National Committee favoring one candidate over the other, and finally Hillary's failing health, whether it's her fainting episodes or the coughing fits. So what's the solution? Shoot Trump? The option isn't far-fetched. After all, the United States has boasted of more president shootings than any other country in the world.
Russia has state-run media. Here in the United States, we have global corporate-run media that literally has seized control of our nation. And just as Putin helped kick the oligarchs out of Russia, we're seeing the exact same thing begin to unfold here with Donald J. Trump leading a movement to kick the same oligarchs out of the United States. That's why they've tripled down, even in the Washington Post today, and are now claiming that Putin may be poisoning Hillary. Now, wait a minute. I thought that it was a conspiracy theory that she was even sick. But now the Russians are behind her illness. Ladies and gentlemen, we have foreigners already running our country. We already have globalists. And so they're trying to manipulate our nationalism against the Russians, hoping that we don't see the real threat internally that has hijacked our nation. I'm Alex Jones reporting for InfoWars.com. And we are live, ladies and gentlemen, 27 minutes into this four-hour global transmission on this Wednesday. That video is being posted right now with the English translation to the article up on InfoWars.com and DrudgeReport.com. This is very, very important information to get out. Putin appointed TV host. That's basically the mouth of Putin is coming out and saying they're concerned that Donald Trump will be killed. Well, of course, anybody with half a brain should be concerned. This is obviously the next course of action for the globalists if they think they can get away with it. But as you've noticed, everything they do tends to disintegrate and turn to dirt. When we come back from break, I'm going to get into the clip and the news article where the Washington Post is actually writing articles and interviewing, quote, experts saying we need to see if Putin is poisoning Hillary Clinton. You know, they call this the new McCarthyism, but McCarthy, it turned out, was pretty much right. He just went after low-level people. And it was oligarch globalist financing communism so they could have basically centralized government to control the resources of Russia, China, and other areas. But it turns out Joseph McCarthy was right. In this case, this is just Hillary and the New World Order and the neocons, who actually were Trotskyites, actual communists, it's funny enough, running around claiming that anyone that is against the New World Order and for national sovereignty is the opposite of a patriot, is the opposite of a nationalist, and supposedly is on the Russian payroll. Hillary Clinton, Rachel Maddow, her surrogates have all said that the godfather of the Trump movement is Vladimir Putin. That is ridiculous.
They claim that I get my marching orders from Putin. I've been on air 21 years. Since before Vladimir Putin was even, you know, president of Russia or vice president for that matter. It's just totally asinine. But they sit there and they push it. No, the globalists have hijacked the country and people working for them are collaborators to global corporate conquest. That's what we're facing. And many of them work for the communist Chinese and are involved in espionage, like Hillary Rodham Clinton. That's a fact in the DC leaks and the WikiLeaks. Ladies and gentlemen, history is happening. I want to thank you all for your prayers, your support, spreading the articles, the videos. You are soldiers, every man, woman, and child of you, regardless of what color you are or where you're from, in the fight against globalists. They're building a world that's going to be free of humans, where they merge with machines and become gods, they believe. Rachel Maddow and others make fun of me on almost a daily basis for saying that, but all I'm doing is quoting the lead scientist at Google and other major companies. This is their goal. Whether they're going to be able to attain this goal or not is a question. But those of us covering this are not the ones who are insane. We are covering twisted people. And they have this paradox where they try to act like we're the crazy people for covering all the weird stuff they're involved in and not the other way around. I mean, look at this out of the London Telegraph. Motherless babies possible as scientists create live offspring without need for female egg. And artificial wombs, and the list goes on and on. I'm going to extend this for one day and one day only. Quite frankly, because we're not ready to launch our new special yet until tomorrow. And I would take advantage of it because contractually I'm already supposed to be stopping this. But when you're the number one distributor of the one of the largest companies in the nation, Storable Foods, you're allowed to, I guess, bend the rules a bit to get people the best deals. 30 to 40% off all of the entire line of My Patriot Supply Foods, private labeled under the name InfoWars Select. You can buy the same great food right next to it at InfoWarsStore.com if you'd rather pay 30 to 40% more and have the My Patriot Supply label. Exact same food, same age, produced right here in America. They've got their plants turned up so high that a lot of times this food has been packaged a day or two before it's put on an 18-wheeler and rolled out to your town, your city. And nobody can beat these prices. The selection, the quality, you know, there's a nexus for how much you pay and the quality. Really good quality, but really low price. Quite frankly, you can pay three, four times this and get stuff that is like gourmet. But a lot of this tastes really, really good. All of it is decent, and a lot of it is extremely delicious. But there's a nexus point. This is what I chose for my family, what I've chosen for the office, what I'm stockpiling, because it's super high quality, really tasty, really durable, packaged properly, lasts the longest. And it's the lowest price. I mean, there is stuff that tastes like dirt that is more than this. You just cannot find a better bang for your buck than the My Patriot Supply Food at InfoWarsStore.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. And by the way, I've gone from having the solar panel system and the well water and living out in the country and having some storable food to ramping up to going on to solar and putting in another well and getting more storable food and getting more firearms. And quite frankly, I'm going into the area of getting the gourmet storable food, which we're not selling yet, but I'm testing it all out and trying to make deals right now. So we'll also have that little bit of caviar level stuff that you have kind of as dessert with the stockpile. So a lot of stuff's happening here. The point is, what we sell is what I use and what I've researched and what I am having in my emergency preparedness myself. Quite frankly, I'd have four or five other major food sponsors. It's just hard to find somebody this good for the price. The only other galaxy when it comes to storable food is the super gourmet stuff. And quite frankly, I'm diving into it because, man, there's some really good stuff out there. So I'm in the middle of that enjoyable research. When I take my son, you know, dove hunting or something for the weekend, or I go camping with the kids, or I go fishing with the kids and the family, I'm deep in research of gourmet storable food. It'll be showing up in the next month or so at InfoWarsStore.com. And again, the reason I'm doubling down and really getting into this is because it's gone from a possibility to a probability to a certainty that we're going to see things get worse and worse, at least for the foreseeable future, but then things will get better after that. I don't know how bad this global meltdown is going to be. I don't know how big these wars are going to be. All I know is most elites moving to New Zealand. They're leaving the United States. They're leaving Israel. They're leaving Europe. They're running for the hills. The Russians are digging in. It's in mainstream news. The Russians are buying emergency storable food and digging in. I mean, it is a crazy time. There was a big headline a few days ago or last week that world experts agree the planet has never been in greater danger of World War III. Now, I'm not saying World War III is a certainty, but global financial meltdown, crises, social problems are clearly intensifying and have gone from a probability to a certainty because they're already happening and it's getting worse. And you've got George Soros and the rest of the globalists running around trying to divert everybody from the huge crimes they've committed and all the bad things they've done with having us all fight with each other. We're seeing weaponized culture war garbage being carried out along ethnic and religious lines all over the world. And that's why I am personally getting prepared. And yes, funding our information war with a symbiotic program of getting people prepared with the very best quality, very lowest prices we can on nutraceuticals, on the supplements. But I've gone from maybe 10% getting prepared and 90% offense to 70% offense, 30% defense. Now, some will say, well, it seems like you're working harder. Yes, I've overall upped my amount of resistance and our operation. So even though I've cut back in the overall pie on how much time I spend trying to save things, we're fighting harder than ever, but we're fighting to try to fix things. We're fighting to try to stave things off. We're fighting to try to stabilize. We're fighting to try to warn people. We're fighting to try to reach out to other countries and other groups that don't want to have World War III, to have alliances of just ideology, alliances of sanity. We're doing everything we can. And quite frankly, I have to take care of my kids. And so I'm just telling you, never in 20 plus years on air have I started digging in. And I'm digging in now. And it's because my instinct tells me that we've got some rough times ahead. And you're going to see, as things get worse and worse, who's who. You're going to see people you thought were patriots flip and work for the enemy. You're going to see folks you thought were on the fence or with the enemy come over to our side. Because the battle lines are getting clear. 20 years ago, it wasn't clear who was who. 10 years ago, it wasn't that clear. Not even 5 years ago. It's crystal clear right now. And that's why we go to this next report. Now, the New York Daily News, Democrat run, are openly saying he should step down. It's outrageous. It's terrible. We have seen Hillary Clinton come out and say that Trump supporters are deplorable. And the media come out and say all of them are deplorable and basically aren't even humans. We've heard her say that the alt-right, that is the real right, doesn't have a right to exist. And we're hearing Final Solution type talk. We're seeing announcements they're going after the press. We're seeing huge developments. We're seeing the media work lockstep in deception. And so the governor, who I'm a fan of, by the way, just when I see him on TV and stuff talking and his initiative to bring jobs to Kentucky, came out and said, listen, blood's going to get spilled. The Tree of Liberty. Well, that's the kind of stuff George Washington and Thomas Jefferson and Barry Goldwater and Ronald Reagan said. It's like when Trump says, if we lose the election and the courts take our guns, we have no recourse, I guess, but the Second Amendment. That's what everybody from Charlton Heston to Ronald Reagan to yours truly has said, to Ted Nugent. I mean, that is a standard refrain of come and take it from my cold dead hands. And they acted like that Trump should stand down, Trump should resign, Trump should be disqualified because of that statement, while Hillary and the globalists destabilize the nation. No, this guy is now presidential material down the road. Kentucky governor urged to resign after saying blood will be shed. Well, see, he's a former business owner. He's a company owner. He's like Trump. He doesn't want power. He's taking a demotion to be governor. You think real people that actually have jobs and create jobs and work hard and like to get things done and are problem solvers, you think they want to work in government? The Republican governor of Kentucky foolishly, they say, implied Americans will have to die if Hillary Clinton wins this November, and calls for his impeachment are now amassing. So that's how they spin it. No, calls for him to be given a medal are now increasing. speaking at the Voters Values Summit, Washington, D.C., on Saturday, they just now found it, a loosely Thomas Jefferson quoting Governor Matt Bevin bizarrely hinted at his own children having to shed blood. So this is all hypothetical, down the road, someday we might have to go to the Second Amendment. That's in the Declaration of Independence, that it's our right and duty. So he quotes Thomas Jefferson, and they start running around saying he should have to step down. Next, they'll say he should be arrested. See, even though the New York Times says kill Donald Trump, that's okay. So that's where they're going. I have 9 children. It breaks my heart to think that it might be their blood that is needed to redeem something, to reclaim something that we, through our apathy and our indifference, have given away. He went on to appropriate a segment of a letter written by Thomas Jefferson in 1787, which in part states, the Tree of Liberty must be refreshed from time to time with the blood of patriots and tyrants. We have a t-shirt that says that. A Gadsden flag yellow t-shirt that we sell at InfoWarsStore.com that says the quote on the back. It's a yellow shirt like the flag. I mean, they are taking normal Americana and making it dirty now. So here is the governor quoting the third president of the United States. So the occupiers, the globalists, the political aliens to our system are freaked out by it. Because they don't breathe this oxygen that we breathe. They breathe the foul fumes of hell based on bondage and enslavement and systems like North Korea.
If Hillary Clinton were to win the election, do you think it's possible that we'll be able to survive? That would we ever be able to recover as a nation? And while there are people who have stood on this stage and said we would not, I would beg to differ, but I will tell you this. I do think it would be possible, but at what price? At what price? The roots of the tree of liberty are watered by what? The blood of who? The tyrants, to be sure, but who else? The patriots. Whose blood will be shed? It may be that of those in this room. It might be that of our children and grandchildren. I have 9 children. It breaks my heart to think that it might be their blood that is needed to redeem something, to reclaim something that we, through our apathy and our indifference, have given away. Don't let it happen. Of and by and for the people.
Absolutely.
Means of and by and for the people. This is our right. It is our privilege. This is not something that came by accident, nor will it be preserved by indifference. It takes the people being engaged. When our founding fathers pledged their lives and their fortunes and their sacred honors, this wasn't a bumper sticker. They weren't trying to get elected to something. Every one of them gave some or all of those things. A tremendous sacrifice.
For those that don't know, maybe you're new listeners, maybe you're Rachel Maddow tuning into the White House, he's quoted the Declaration of Independence. Most of that speech is Declaration of Independence mixed in with a guy that wrote most of it. He's credited with writing about 80% of it, Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson wrote the Declaration of Independence, then they debated it and passed it around and changed it, and he rewrote it. He wrote it. So the reason Thomas Jefferson in 1887 sounds like the Thomas Jefferson in 1776 is because it's the same Thomas Jefferson. It's all Thomas Jefferson, the founder of the Democratic Party. Now, he was the guy who tried in the first Declaration of Independence to ban slavery. He also tried in the first Constitution. You just couldn't do it because it was 500,000 people. And what do? Send folks back to Africa. And there were people that did not want black people to be free. But the point is, America, at the same time, England was trying to ban slavery. England did it about 60 years earlier than we did, and England led the world in banning it, attacked scores of countries and dozens and dozens of nations' ships for 60-plus years, including American ships, to ban slavery. That's why by, 1810 or so, the transatlantic slave trade was over, because the British would attack you. And the only reason I raise this is, the only people that kept slavery going after that was the Arabs. And I'm not attacking the Arabs. Most Arabs aren't involved in slavery. The point is that This isn't taught in school. Collectively, we're taught Europe invented slavery, the U.S. perfected slavery, and it's not true. 2% of Southerners owned slaves. It's crazy. What a red herring this is. And I'm not defending it. It's just not true that America is all about it. America tried to end this evil. And America has been all about trying to transcend it all along. And we never even began to scale the heights of the Declaration of Independence, Bill of Rights, Constitution, and the Renaissance and those ideas that it represented. But just getting a little bit of it created such wealth the world's never seen it. Such freedom. And that's why the globalists are in competition with the American system. They want to get rid of it because it's the Renaissance. It's the Enlightenment. It is science. It is freedom. It is openness. It is free association. It is the Renaissance that ended classism. You say, well, it's still here today. No, I mean, it in its declaration ended it and began a system where anybody in the world could potentially end up become successful and wealthy in America. Anybody born here could end up being the president of the United States or a member of Congress. Well, who wants to do that? Go set up your own company. Chart your own future. I want to go out to break because what the governor said is so evil, is so horrible. Why, you better resign. They're making classic Americana somehow dirty, like pornography. With a little clip of myself 3 years ago speaking for the first time ever, they let somebody have a political speech at the Alamo because it was just a warehouse of the 50s and the Daughters of the Republic of Texas, who were great folks, a lot of my family. Relatives took it over and said, we're not going to let it be political. Well, it got taken over by patriots and the state government. And now we do have our political rallies there. And I'm so honored to be one of the first people to speak at the Alamo after it was resurrected. Here's part of that speech.
We're not turning our guns in, and we're not running, and we're not backing down. If you want to, come and take them.
We are on the march. The Empire is on the run. Live from the InfoWars.
We'll be back, ladies
studios,
and gentlemen. Stay
it's
with us.
Alex Jones.
Again, I thought I'd just play a piece of that clip because, I'm proud of America. I'm proud of what we've done. I'm proud of the fact that we have more inventions and more wealth. The United States was 4% of the world's population. We're now 6% out of 100. And we had 50% of the wealth until about 15 years ago. And people say, oh, you're rich, you're greedy, you're evil, you exploited. That was the American system outside of globalism. Now that globalism's coming in, we're getting poor, and everybody else is, but a few tiny elites. And they admit that's their system. Tiny elites, crony capitalism, a.k.a. feudalism. We'll be back with huge news for the latest hacks. We are back in other news. Stories up on InfoWars.com. Concussion pathologist claims Trump and Putin have poisoned Hillary, and the Washington Post actually reports on it with no proof. So not only is Putin magically running Trump and myself and everybody else who doesn't want to live under Goldman Sachs and J.P. Morgan multinational rule, now they've poisoned Hillary. That story is up on InfoWars.com by Steve Watson. But the big story is on DrudgeReport.com. This is such a big deal because this is internal emails with Democrats that are friends of Hillary Clinton, people that wouldn't want to be saying she's sick if she isn't, talking to Colin Powell. Hacked email, Colin Powell, Dem donor, worried over Clinton's health in 2015. Former Secretary of State Colin Powell and major Democratic donor Jeffrey Leeds worryingly discussed Hillary Clinton's health in March of last year. Hacked email show. Because they're all part of the same crew, folks. Powell's been a Democrat, just like George Herbert Walker. These people vacation together. It's sick. The email exchange provided to several journalists by DC Leaks, a website with ties to Lucifer 2.0, reveals how Clinton health has been a topic of discussion among political heavyweights for some time. I want to just say great job, Mikhail Phelan, our hack beat reporter. He covers hacking, does a great job for staying up so late last night to be the first to break this. On HDTV, These are the emails. She doesn't look so good. On HDTV, she doesn't look good. Powell, who is believed to have around 30,000 emails hacked, wrote on March 14th, she is working herself to death. She will turn 70 her first year in office. In response, Leeds recalled a convention conversation with Rhode Island Democrat Senator Sheldon Whitehouse regarding Clinton's difficulty in traversing a set of steps. Sheldon Whitehouse, who is a huge Clinton supporter, this is a quote from the email, said they were both giving speeches at the same time, the same event a few months back, and she could barely climb the podium steps, Leeds wrote. The back and forth will undoubtedly increase skepticism among American voters already worried over Clinton's increasingly public health issues. You know, for me, and the article goes on, for me, the bigger issue is all these reporters going, look, she wobbled, she stumbled. And then they don't show her falling down and being dragged into the vehicle. CNN, MSNBC, and then I have other clips coming up where we have, well, in fact, let's try to play it down if we have time. Clinton on CBS live saying, yeah, no, she faints all the time. She falls, and then they change it, and because he catches himself, he goes, I mean, over the years, she's fallen some. They edit that out and edit it to where he didn't say that. I mean, this is weaponized media. Let's go to that clip of Clinton. The story's up on Infowars.com. CBS News edits out Bill Clinton saying Hillary has frequently to rarely had similar episodes, because he changes it to rarely later. They edit it together to deceive the public. Here it is.
When you look at that collapse, that video that was taken, you wonder if it's not more serious.
No,
than dehydration.
She's been, well, if it is, it's a mystery to me and all of her doctors, because rarely, but on more than one occasion over the last many, many years, the same sort of things happened to her when she just got severely dehydrated.
Okay, now here's the edited part. This is what's re-aired all over the place.
All
right, now you saw that. We're going to break, but notice they put roads over it when they made the cut. I mean, these people are incredible.
What are you going to do when you go on stage with Donald Trump? Well, the answer is don't get on the stage with Donald Trump.
Well, now the official mouthpiece of the Democratic Party, the Washington Post, has come out and said that Hillary might not get better from her pneumonia until late October, a month and a half from now, and may have to miss the first debate or debates with Donald Trump. Isn't that convenient? We've said over and over again, there's no way this woman, who in over a year and a half never gives more than a 15, 20-minute speech, who was never on stage more than 30 minutes, there's no way that she can stand on stage for an hour and a half with Donald Trump. Even during Democrat debates, they have to wait an extra 10 minutes or so for her to come back on stage.
And do we believe Secretary Clinton will be coming around the corner any minute? But in the meantime, we want to start with this eye-opening number. And Senator Sanders, this question goes to you first.
We had a reporter's a week and a half ago in Ohio, where she had to go in a medical tent for 45 minutes with them running in there with stretchers until she could go out on stage and have a five-minute hacking fit and have to cancel her speech. Then she couldn't give a press conference that afternoon. There are hundreds and hundreds of examples of this. But don't worry, her husband, Bill Clinton, last night on Charlie Rose, came out and said that Hillary is working like a demon.
Over the last many, many years, the same sort of things happened to her when she just got severely dehydrated. And she's worked like a demon, as you know, as Secretary of State and as a senator, and in the years since.
Importantly, she's on a grueling campaign.
Yeah.
So there you have it. Bill Clinton's finally telling the truth and agreeing with Julian Assange that Hillary is a demon. I wonder if Hillary will now come out and basically admit that she does want to put the free press's neck in a noose, just like the globalists have already put our economy in a noose. But bottom line, yesterday we talked about tweets put out by the Democrats saying they were meeting at the DNC in D.C. talking about getting a replacement for Hillary. The media said we were conspiracy theorists. But today, there were hundreds of publications admitting that indeed that they're looking at a possible replacement for Hillary Clinton. Now, I'm not saying that's going to happen.
I'm simply saying, how do you run this unpopular zombie against Donald Trump when he's rising in the polls and she's falling in the polls, especially after she called half of Trump's supporters deplorable and her own minions said they're all deplorable?
You can put half of Trump's supporters into what I call the basket of deplorables. Right? The racist, sexist, homophobic, xenophobic, Islamophobic, you name it.
Do you think it's tough to defend the remark deplorables to stereotype a group of people?
Absolutely not. I think that her only mistake is that she said half of his supporters were deplorable. Does anybody around this table, have they not seen Trump's rallies? Have they not seen Trump's own remarks? What she said was not wrong. Her only mistake was that she described half of his supporters that way. Well,
that the government should allow Hillary Clinton to become president of the United States.
She has disqualified herself as the president of the United States. So look for false flags. Look for staged events. Look for made-up crises. Look for them to play the race card harder than ever in an attempt to divide and conquer this nation. But the truth is, the American people are waking up to the globalist. And the fact that America has its problems, and we're going to fix it as Americans, regardless of what color we are. But we don't need George Soros and offshore banks to come in here and stir things up so they can rob and loot this nation. We're aware of what's happening, and the sleeping giant that is America has risen. The people that are the resistance are awake, and they're ready to take action.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, we've got breaking news. I may have to withdraw my support for Donald J. Trump. It turns out his sons have been involved in some incredibly evil activities. They've been caught hunting endangered species. This is terrible news. We're going to come back and show you the shocking photos and video straight ahead and get Gavin McGinnis's take on this game-changing event. Well, I'm not bragging, but it is surreal to routinely have the top link on the internet. Bigger than the top New York Times, bigger than the top story on Facebook, the top of drudgereport.com. But, of course, it does deserve the link. Our great internet news reporter slash hacking news expert, Mikhail Thalen, stayed up till, I'm told, 3, 4 in the evening last night to get the exclusive on the hacked emails with good old former Secretary of State and former architect of the first Iraq War, Colin Powell. And in there, they're talking about Hillary Clinton can't go up 2 or 3 stairs to give a speech. They're really worried about her health a year ago. So this is her own allies worried about it. But there's also in the emails the fact that they kept saying, we'll quit pointing at you using emails in a private server if you endorse Hillary. Wow, talk about influence peddling. The plot thickens. And Gavin McGinnis is a serial entrepreneur, one of the founders of Vice Media. He has the Gavin McGinnis Show that airs for a couple hours every day right before my show starts on compoundmedia.com. Really interesting guy. We appreciate him coming on the broadcast. He's a frequent contributor. He's seen a lot of big national, international TV shows as well. He's a comedian, really smart guy. He'll be with us for the rest of the hour. And I want to get into all the serious news. But since I made the joke earlier in the last segment, let me just be clear. I'm fully behind Trump. If I ever had questions about him a year and a half ago, I don't. His stamina, his patriotism, being attacked by all these people, going to Mexico, going to Louisiana, all these big coups he's had. I mean, he's running against a corpse, Hillary. But I'm really proud of the fact that the guy is an American. He is a patriot. He makes America young again. We had a guest on yesterday making that point. It's not even make America great again. It's make America feel young again, like we're doing something. We're taking action. We're not, you know, broke back, drooling in the corner. But America's greatest days are to come. They're not over. Stop going downhill like a snowball headed for hell, to quote Merle Haggard, the late, great Merle Haggard. You can follow him at Twitter, at Gavin_McInnes, McInnes. But most folks know he is. My 14-year-old son's a big fan. And, of course, every other young person I've talked to, but also a lot of folks my age or older. So we're going to be going to him in a moment. But since I mentioned this, I said, listen, we got big news here, folks. I'm going to have to withdraw my support for the Trumps because it's been circulating for weeks on social media, photos of them big game hunting, Triceratops, Pterodactyl, Brachiosaur, Diplodocus, other creatures. In fact, they've been out in the ocean with big harpoon guns, hunting plesiosaurs. I mean, this is a serious situation, okay? And these are seriously endangered species, okay? Well, Mark Dice goes out, and he shows in his video. He's coming on next hour reporting from InfoWars.com, of MarkDice.com. He goes out, and he talks to Southern Californians, and this is everyone he talked to. I'm not going to play the whole clip. I'll play it next hour. But it seems like a lot of folks are waking up. We're taking action. People are really starting to see what's happening, except they've still got half the public that can't find their ass with both hands. I don't say that with pleasure, like a Hillary Clinton preying on these people. They call us deplorable because we want to bring back prosperity and free market and private property and where, you know, men can wear pants and it's okay. But their voters, literally, 9 out of 10 say put gun owners in forced labor camps. Their voters say, yes, the Trump sons are horrible for hunting Triceratops. Folks, Triceratops has been gone for 25 million years. So let's play just a minute or two of this Mark Dice report, because I want to start here with Gavin McInnes here on this second hour. Let's go ahead and play the invincibly ignorant supporters of Hillary.
You might have seen the Donald Trump kids are big hunters. They go on these hunting trips just for fun and kill these poor animals. So now, just getting people's reactions to Donald Trump's kids now killing the Triceratops in Africa on a hunting expedition.
Okay, so honestly, my opinion is I think they're just getting away with a lot for the simple fact that they're Donald Trump's children.
Would an ordinary person be able to get away with killing a Triceratops, or is the Donald Trump's kids just being able to get away with that because they're Donald Trump's kids?
I think they're getting away with it because they're Donald Trump's kids, and I think anybody else would just get in trouble, and they're honestly just, I don't know,
with
jail
the
time.
Animal rights activists.
Yeah, they'll pay a fine for it, and they'll serve their time in jail and
for killing the Triceratops. I think it's an endangered species in some countries, so makes it even worse.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I agree.
All right, thank you very much. Triceratops is on the endangered species list. Now Donald Trump Jr., a big game hunter, just killed Triceratops and posted a picture posing with the dead animal's body.
Okay, let's stop right there. He goes into woolly mammoths, saber-toothed tigers. I'm going to go out in Austin, I think, this weekend and go to the trendy areas, the supposed smartest areas. I'm going to go to UT, and I guarantee you, Californians, that's San Diego, where all of them are 9 out of 10 on average, don't know what planet they're on. I bet 8 out of 10 say, yes, arrest Trump for letting his sons hunt Stegosaurus, which we all know back in the 1930s, King Kong battles and kills a Stegosaurus and a Tyrannosaurus Rex. So I want to ask Gavin McInnes, how do we defeat this level of ignorance, sir?
It's not easy. I mean, what's going on here is it's clearly fashion to them. It's clearly sports. They've never been outside. They don't care what happens. I mean, if Hillary is so sick that she's collapsing and she's got catheters falling out of her pants, the left says that she's a badass and that she's campaigning while under the suffering pain of pneumonia. If we say that the Trump kids are killing dinosaurs, they say it's because Trump is rich. I mean, am I crazy or are we more open-minded than them? I think we're into the truth. And I think the hatred for Trump on the right is actually a good example of how open to the truth we are. I mean, he says something about free speech, persecuting journalists who smear him. The right gets really mad. We have almost a third of the right now is still fighting against Trump, whereas the left, Hillary can do no wrong, just as Trump can do no right. And you realize you guys aren't in it for the facts. You're not in it for the truth. You're not in it for justice. You're in it for fashion. You could have said that Trump's kids think they're doing a favor by preserving the Triceratops, but the Triceratops has been extinct. And I bet you these students would say, yeah, they're just showboating. I mean, the Triceratops is never coming back, and it's just fake.
So you're saying it's okay to kill the Triceratops?
I'm saying it's okay to kill the Triceratops. I don't like the Triceratops. It's a very deadly animal. Have you seen those horns? There's a reason God pieced it out of here. It's trouble.
Absolutely. In fact, thank God that Donald Trump Jr. killed the last Triceratops.
They're a vicious animal. And it's not just those horns that are a problem. They've got that huge casing around the horns. They've got their tiny little walnut brain. They're a menace to society. I'm glad that the Trump kids are getting rid of them.
Got a good point about walnut brains. I mean, we need to get rid of them. But hey, I bet the Triceratops would score higher on the ACT or the different tests than the actual Hillary supporters.
Doesn't one of them have a brain in its ass? I think the Stegosaurus has a brain. It has a tail brain.
Exactly. Well, maybe Hillary's the Stegosaurus of politicians. What do you make of the current climate? I mean, what moment have we entered? Because it's so surreal now where she's falling down and the media won't even show her falling down. They just show her wobbling and say, what's the big deal? Not knowing their viewers can just go see it online. I mean, it's like the mainstream media is finally committing suicide with what little bit of credibility they had left.
Well, they don't leave. You know, they don't leave their little bubble, so they don't go outside, and that's why they can say Triceratops killing is wrong, because they've never even looked at big game hunting. They don't know anything about any of that stuff. They've never been outside. And as far as the Hillary thing goes, all they know is the internet. They see the alt-right is putting up a frog picture, so Hillary starts addressing Pepe the Frog like it's this major scourge. And you go, lady, leave Reddit for maybe an hour and a half. Get outside. Get some fresh air. And the fact that they think that they can kill this story, I mean, the original guy who put it on Twitter, he's got some weird sort of a Bosnian name like Zagar Gdesk or something. They've shut him down, and then they shut down Paul Joseph Watson, didn't they? They shut him down.
Oh, yeah, they started taking our videos down.
They started taking it down like you can do that. I mean, it's everywhere right now. And the fact that they think that they can stop it shows how incredibly naive they are. They're sort of lost in a meme hole. They're like they accuse us of being the fat guys in the basement drinking the Super Gulp. But it seems like the entire Democratic Party is locked in the basement only checking out memes. That video is out. We know she's sick, and I'll tell you what. She is so sick that I am worried about her. Us Trump supporters are petrified we're going to lose her before November. After the election, I don't care what happens to her, but right now, I would take a bullet for her.
Gavin, I agree, because they're going to put somebody in better than her. I'm really worried about the sympathy vote when they admit she's got a big old fat brain tumor bigger than that walnut.
Same with Obama. I would take a bullet for Obama just to avoid having to hear about the first black president being assassinated for the rest of our
lives. I agree with you. My biggest concern is them pulling a false flag or some nut killing one of them. I am literally praying every night for Hillary Clinton's safety.
Obama would put us in a state of emergency, and he would delay the election at best, choose his own candidate at worst, or it's conceivable that he would just continue his presidency for, I don't know, another year, another 2 years. Bloomberg did it.
Well, Gavin, you know that's still being openly discussed, which is so crazy. That's why it's surreal. Did you see the Washington Post? They came out with a concussion pathologist claiming, they don't just say it could be, they say he thinks Putin is, with Trump, poisoning Hillary. So we've gone from she's not sick to she's being poisoned. I'm going to skip this break. This is so important. So now Putin isn't just running all of us, magical unicorn creature that he is, but now he's poisoning Hillary.
Remember when Alex Jones was nuts? Remember when InfoWars was considered fringe conspiracy theory stuff? Now you guys are the sane ones and everyone else is nuts. I mean, I used to think that the government was too incompetent to come up with scams, but we're seeing every day really suspicious stuff. Like, they're denying that she's sick as we watch her collapse. Well, here's another thing that used to be relegated to the fringes of society. Remember when she came out of Chelsea's apartment? Wasn't it curious that she was totally alone like that? She had 20 feet of space.
It was meant to make it like she was this goddess just randomly coming out, so the little girl from behind the police and Secret Service line could run up out of Wag the Dog. It was so staged. It was like Kim Jong-il or Un in North Korea.
I am open to the possibility that it was a body double. And they have all of the bodyguards surrounding the real Hillary, and they think, well, she's disposable. She's just some woman from Missouri.
A lot of presidents have used body doubles. I mean, you know, why not?
I mean, why is there no one around her right now? Isn't that odd? I've never seen her with a 30-foot radius of nothing.
That's a good point. Why wouldn't you know? Exactly. The Secret Service is supposed to be around her.
She could be assassinated right now, God forbid.
And by the way, there were people screaming at her that she was a liar and stuff while this happened.
It is really unusual, and I don't care what happens after November, but we have to keep at least a semblance of an election going so Trump can destroy her. I mean, it was sort of like a fight where someone was coming out of retirement to step in the ring, and all the fans of the fit boxer were saying, I can't wait to see him destroy this old codger. And now we're worried this guy isn't even going to make it into the ring. Like, Trump, it was going to be fun to watch Trump.
Oh, remember, he couldn't win anything. He wouldn't get a primary. We were all a joke a year and a half ago. So I remember at Thanksgiving with family, like, I mean, literally, like, 15 family members laughing at me at Thanksgiving when I said, watch, he'll be the next president.
Look at Ann Coulter on Bill Maher's show. She said, out of all the potentials here, I think Trump is going to be the nominee. And the entire audience was hysterical, laughing. If I had a nickel for every time someone calls me and says, oh, your boy Trump just screwed himself, the party's over, he's done. It must have happened at least 20 times.
Well, he's literally Hitler. In fact, I like that T-shirt. Tell us about that, Gavin.
Everyone you dislike is Hitler. And it's funny because now Hitler just means a guy. It's like the word racism. It used to mar you. Now it just means nice. It's the least descriptive
word. And by the way, I agree with you. The problem is, if you look at state-run media, the talking points go out, how they all do exactly what Hillary and the Democrats say, and how they want to persecute the alt-right, shut down the press. She says, quote, in a fundraising letter 2 weeks ago, that, quote, Breitbart and the alt-right have no right to exist. That is literal Nazi quotes, that the Jews have no right to exist, or these Christian groups have no right to exist, or labor unions have no right to exist. That is Nazi terminology. So now I can't say literally Hitler, even when it's literally Hitler.
Yes. Well, it's I find it more Stalin-esque. Did you hear about this guy? I think he works at the post office. He didn't want to watch a movie about LGBT awareness and tolerance and how awesome gay people are. He said, I don't want to watch that. It's against my religion. It's not something I support. They said, you have to sit and watch it alone in a room. Watch this video like Clockwork Orange. He refused. They sent him home for 2 days without pay. He comes back. They say, you have to watch this movie or you're fired. And you think, maybe if this was a private organization, it was called Gay Blueberry Muffins, and it was exclusive to homosexuals.
Sure, exactly. I mean, if some group said, you've got to go watch daisies being picked, you're in a freaking cult, man. I mean, it's like crazy.
Well, they really are out to destroy Christianity. They're out to destroy America.
Yeah, why is that? Why is it? Because it's a competing ideology? I mean, what's going on here?
That's a good question. I mean, I think it could be as simple as daddy issues. My daddy is a Christian. He's a Catholic. I want to make Catholicism immoral and wrong and illegal, so I don't feel so bad about blowing $60,000 of his money taking philosophy of self in college for 5 years.
But meanwhile, dad's already dead. They're like fighting a dad from 50 years ago. We've moved on. I see myself as the real liberal, and I see a bunch of authoritarian people obsessed with their, you know, weird sexual practices running around that aren't even any fun. And I'm just like, you people are a bunch of kooks.
Well, that's the beauty of libertarianism in the information age. The truth just seeps out. And we started an organization here at the show called the Proud Boys, where we simply state, we are Western chauvinists who refuse to apologize for creating the modern world. And we have these meetings where there's that we just did one on September 11th. 50 guys show up. We take over the whole bar. We lock people out who aren't Proud Boys, cheer USA, read from Pat Buchanan's Death of the West. And you feel this tsunami of patriotism going on here, especially with young men, where they go, we tried being ashamed of ourselves. We tried this sort of sabotage society thing. And as you say, it's rebelling against a dead dad. I think I'm going to enjoy my greatness now. And that's what I love about Trump. He's not just saying make America great again. He's saying accept that we're great and enjoy it.
And I'll expand on that. I want to make America greater. So I've criticized problems. I've criticized the police. But it doesn't mean I want to kill the police. It doesn't mean I realize that we're falling. And so I want to make us great and successful and have a renaissance. It doesn't mean I hate America. And so I always kind of thought the left was misguided. But, you know, they just wanted to try to fix things. But I agree with you. And I had Michael Savage on yesterday, Dr. Savage. He said, no. It's true, and I've had so many listeners call in and guests go, hey, that guy Gavin McGinnis, he's right on your show. They want to just blow it all up because they can't compete with it. They hate themselves. They can't compete with real liberalism, real freedom, real renaissance. They've tried to steal the mantle of liberalism, and so they can't compete with it. They want to just blow everything up.
And I think they're starting to realize they chose the wrong team. They thought they were choosing the cool, rebellious team. And then they see Milo Yiannopoulos write dangerous faggot tour on the side of his bus and go from college to college getting kicked out. And they go, when did I become the church lady? I thought I was a rebel. Now they're the ones that are saying, screw you, authority. I want to be on that team. And to watch them suffer as they sit there with their rule book going, you're not allowed to say that, you're not allowed to do that. They're even cannibalizing themselves now. They're getting each other fired because they can't keep up with this this crazy.
Sure, sure. You're taking a bunch of weak nerds. You're taking a bunch of weak nerds and people that were always scared to be a bully to start a fight. But it wasn't that they weren't bullies. They were worse than bullies. Now they've built a system for themselves to be bullies. But like you said, only their own people are within their system now, so they can only attack each other. They haven't successfully taken over everything, so they're cannibalizing themselves.
They want to be dominated, too, at the end of the day. That's the weird thing about this. I don't think they really want Hillary. I don't think they really wanted Bernie. They're like a spoiled brat who wanted to scream and cry, but then they're just sort of testing our boundaries. You know, they want a timeout. They want to be sent to their room. They don't really want to be in control. And we've seen what happens when they do get into control. It's like ISIS. It's like radical Islam. You say, okay, here's your own town. Wear burqas. The next thing you know, they're caning some woman because you can see her purple socks. And you realize, you guys don't want to be in control. You just want a bitch.
They want to make their economy about bitching and whining and mental illness instead of an economy of factories and rockets and life extension and computer technology and going to the stars.
I really feel like there's sort of this hysterical girlfriend going, go ahead, hit me, bitch. You think you can hit me? You're not a man. Hit me, bitch. And then I think the entire left just wants us to go by electing Trump, and they'll go, ooh, that kind of turned me on. I guess we're making America great again.
That's all happened to us, that moment where a woman tells you to slap them and you're not going to do it, and they're very upset with you. Now, or maybe you give them what they want. The point is that we are living in a crazy time. We're going to break. What are some of the other big stories you want to cover? I've got some clips. I've got some news items I want to get into. But I just have this sense of victory and this sense that we're seeing the decline of this mentally ill system that thought it could totally program all of us and control us, and they have jumped the proverbial, you know, big blue whale or shark. But how are they going to strike back? I mean, they're not going to give up power. What are they going to do? I mean, remember, I was a kook saying that they would try to steal the election. Trump came out and seconded it. Then they came out and said, okay, we are federalizing the election.
Yeah. Well, I want to talk about the corruption that Hillary's behind. I mean, everyone says it's crazy conspiracy that people die around her. And I say to those people, where's Obama's death toll? Where's Trump's death toll? Where is Obama's chef? He's making a sandwich. Where's Trump's chef? He's preparing some linguine for tonight.
Where are the Bushes? I never had any political repercussions from the Bushes. When I was criticizing the Clintons 20 years ago, I got beat up in parking lots. I got sued. I got attacked. I got fired. They told me the Clintons are sending a message. Boom, your nose is broken.
The Clintons' chef is face down in a river, found dead, drowned. I don't know how you end up at the bottom of a river when you're going on a camping trip, but that's one of many people that died on a camping trip. The guy who wrote Why Hillary Shouldn't Be in the White House died on the top of a mountain, just got shot. Pew! They call that a suicide. And I think it's interesting that we're seeing all these people pleading the fifth for Hillary's emails and refusing to show up to court. Because look at Whitewater. What happened there? Vince Foster killed himself by shooting himself in the mouth. What? The top investigator jumped off his balcony from his apartment and killed
himself.
Kevin
McGinnis, let's talk about it straight ahead. I'm Alex Jones, and this is The Renaissance. Call it whatever name you want. We want freedom. We want free association. We want it all. We want it now. And we're going to use whatever words we want. Stay with us. This hour is brought to you by Super Male Vitality. We just take a whole bunch of known organic herbs, super concentrate them, cold press them, and put them out. And you can't lose. You're supporting the tip of the spear in the fight against the New World Order. This stuff has dramatic effects for myself personally. Big third-party supplement nutraceutical sites. Give it 5 delicious stars because it is cold-pressed and nobody else is doing this. It is super concentrated. 20% off Super Male Vitality. I quit working out for about a decade. Then I started working out real hard and couldn't lose weight. But as soon as I got on Super Male Vitality and Survival Shield X2, the good halogen, it totally changed my physiology. And over 3 years, everybody's seen it, I lost 70, 80 pounds overall of fat but gained muscle. I mean, this stuff is amazing. In fact, I just finished a bottle in the last couple weeks here. I take a little more than what is recommended on the dosage. I used to only take half of what you're supposed to take, but over time I built tolerance. I noticed my Supermel's gone, so they're running off to get me some right now from the warehouse. Get yours at InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And we have Super Female Vitality. It's pretty much the same formula, but has a few other herbs in it. Works just, I personally like Female Vitality, just even better. Has a little bit more of the vitality kick to it. I'll just take it a few days, see what happens in the morning. See if Papa Dragon isn't lying to you. No, I'm telling you the truth, folks. We're extending one more day and then it's over. The high-quality, storable foods special. With all the craziness going on out there, a man needs to be prepared. Your family needs to be self-sufficient. Firearms, combat training, water filtration, high-quality, storable foods, the very best. At the regular price, it's a great deal. 30-40% off will end today, I promise you. Tomorrow it's gone. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsSelect.com. InfoWars, main site is InfoWarsStore.com, but you can go to InfoWarsSelect.com for the storable foods, InfoWarsLife.com for the nutraceuticals. So it's all available there. I want to thank you all for your support. You have built this organization. We have changed the entire media landscape. More and more media outlets are going to direct sales to fund their operations instead of advertising. That way you can contain it. You, the broadcaster, are responsible for what you're selling. It's a win-win. Now, you hear ads on local stations and networks. I can't vouch for them. I'm sure a lot of them are great. But when you hear me endorse a product, I use it. I believe in it. So thousands and thousands of great products at InfoWarsStore.com. Now, going back to Gavin McGinnis, founder of Vice Media, syndicated radio talk show host, has his own popular program that comes on right before mine every single day, but I have folks on from his network that are on during me. I don't care. I'm in a full-out war here, ladies and gentlemen. I just care about defeating the New World Order. But CompoundMedia.com, find him on Twitter, at Gavin_McInnes, M-C-I-N-N-E-S. Okay, Gavin, you got the floor. I want you to roll here. What do you expect to come? What do you expect to see in this election? The energy level is rising. Again, they're claiming Putin is basically even sucking air into our lungs. We're not breathing on our own accord. We are zombies of Vladimir Putin. Where is this new McCarthyism going? I mean, it really does seem like they are self-immolating right now in the controlled left.
Well, what's unique about this election is we've never had more access to information. We've never had people more curious about things. And it's so easy to look up. Like, I'm sorry to be pedantic about this, but I'm obsessed with these mysterious deaths around Hillary. And Whitewater is a great introduction to this, where you have the investigator die, you have Vince Foster die, you have Susan McDougal. It's all about a shady real estate deal where Susan McDougal got a loan that Bill Clinton forced her to get. She was forced to get this loan, I believe. Jim McDougal, her husband, dies while in prison. The only person that survives is Susan McDougal herself, and that's because she refuses to say a word. So she does, I think, a year and a half or so for contempt of court, and then when she gets out, Bill Clinton pardons her. Now, what are we seeing right now with Hillary's emails? We're seeing everyone go the Susan McDougal route. It seems to be the only way to live when you're up against the Clinton mafia. So they're all saying, I'm not saying a word. I'm fine. I'll go to jail. You know, I know I'll get pardoned by President Hillary when I get out. So they're just, they're absolving themselves from the risk. And that's because they see a pattern there. I mean, what used to be esoteric conspiracy stuff now has all these things you can look up. And I wrote about it recently on tackymag.com, and I said, don't take my word for it. Go look it up. Just choose a random name on the list of, I believe the list is about 70. Just take a random name from that list and look it up. And then, by the way, as we said earlier, compare that list to other presidential candidates' list. You'll see nothing. George Bush has what? 3 people died around him?
What else is on your radar screen?
What else is on my radar screen? Well, obviously, Hillary's sickness is huge. And I think that what I'm really noticing about Trump is that he waited patiently for this. Remember, he even acted like he's like a boxer just biding his time. He said, I'm out. You know what? If I don't win the election, at least I had a good time. You know, I'm doing fine in the workforce. So he almost threatened to quit a long time, about 2 months ago. So we all got nervous. Wait, what's going on? He's always five steps ahead. And I think the only thing that's thwarting his brilliant chess moves is the opponent, the opposite chess player, is already teetering. He's not ready for the knockout. He wants the knockout to happen in late October. But right now, it looks like she's just going to faint on her own.
I agree. They're openly talking about suspending the election or moving it. What do we do about that?
I mean, there's got to be riots in the streets. If there's riots on the streets for a fake story about a guy having his hands up, there's got to be riots in the streets when the president declares illegally a state of emergency and postpones an election. I mean, the left are such gullible pawns that you can create a universe where cops are hunting down black kids.
And where the Trumps are hunting dinosaurs.
Where the Trumps are hunting down dinosaurs. And not only do people take it, but they start to retaliate. I mean, you think you'd Google something before you take to the streets and risk your life on a vigilante quest to even the score when you're not even sure what the score was. We just had two cops. Didn't we just have two cops run over by someone? Was that in Phoenix?
Sure, it's happening all the time. So, Gavin, expanding on this, clearly, even if they steal the election, they lose politically. I mean, they're done. Now, they're bleeding out. Correct me if I'm wrong. Where do you see this going now in the post-Democratic Party, kleptocrat, control freak, mind control, Jim Jones party of controlling language? I mean, this thing is falling apart. Where do you see it going?
It's done. You know, that you always listen to that Zombies song, "This Will Be Our Year." This is our year. They're done. The word racism doesn't mean anything anymore. All this calling everyone Hitler doesn't mean anything anymore. We know that the cops aren't randomly shooting black people. So after Trump gets elected and they come to us and say, this is a safe space, this is a trigger-free zone, we just laugh in their face. And I always said this with the chalkening. Remember the chalkening when they were writing Trump with chalk everywhere? That was the general sort of populace saying, we're not taking this anymore. We're not taking you seriously anymore. We've had enough of the church ladies. And I think it's a great time to be alive. It's a great time to be into the truth because it's sitting right there for us. They've finally been exposed for all their lies. We tried it their way. It doesn't work. And I really believe that 2017 is the year that we make America great again. It's going to be fun.
Well, I want to expand on that because it really is true that I see in some of the radical, you know, religious people, they don't really love God. They want to say you're bad. They have God's answers. They're judging you. It's that very same, like, super extreme Bible thumping that's so repulsive, but it's like leftist Bible thumping. It's even sicker.
I call them the new Victorians. I mean, look at the way they talk about sex. It sounds like Victorian England. You have to put your hand here, then you need permission for that. As we were saying earlier about how liberals don't want their own utopia, women don't want to have sex like that. They don't want you to put your hand on their knee and say, is this okay? Are you enjoying this yet? You just ruined the whole fun of the thing. And the fact that these guys got into sex, they got into comedy, and they started enforcing their puritanism means that they're done because they started hitting Americans where it counts. And I'm not talking about their wallet. I'm talking about their funny bone, their genitalia. As soon as you start ruining sex and comedy, they've already ruined food with all their rules about gluten. Then Americans, even ones who aren't interested in politics, go, so wait, what is this now? You're telling me I can't even have a good laugh and have sex with my girlfriend? Screw you. I'm screwing her.
It is true. I mean, it's a cult of eugenics. It wants to control biology, so it thought it could move that into a political cosmology, but everyone's rejecting it. How do you expect them to then try to counter-strike against this, Gavin McInnes?
Well, it's going to be a complete meltdown, and we see this. We see this on college campus when Milo's doing his tour. The young girls, the feminists who realize that they're going to lose and he's going to do his talk anyway, they have these conniptions where they start screaming and fainting and screaming at the ground. I mean,
they either die. They go, no, it's horrible. I'm scared. Ah, please. And I can't even do it as bad as they do. I mean, it's five times
exactly.
Worse. Help me. Oh, yeah. I'm scared. Oh, he's talking. I mean, these are mental patients.
You've been doing that for years, and it used to be an exaggeration. Now you're understating it. They are.
In fact, will you please do an imitation for us? Go ahead, try it.
Okay, they go like this. Ah! And it's directed at the ground, too. It's not directed at a person. It's just...
We had reporters there covering six guys in Oregon State who were... Five of them were Hispanic, wearing Trump outfits. They shut down the reading room. And when the teacher monitor announces she's in charge and no one listens, she starts going, "I'm scared! No! Ah! Ah!" I mean, what? This is hilarious.
What the hell, man? They've never had confrontation because they've never had a job. If you clean pools, you're going to have that one jerk who doesn't pay his bills, and you got to deal with him, and you got to go in on a Friday and get him on his way to work.
Oh, my God, the jobs I've had where people get in your face and treat you like crap, it's just crazy.
One in 12 is a nightmare. And if you're an entrepreneur, by the way, one in 12 businesses are successful. The other are failures. And these kids have had illegal aliens doing their jobs their whole lives. So when they get out into the real world, they have been incapacitated and they have a meltdown. And this is just one of the many great things about Trump. As we slowly push the illegals back using attrition and they go back with their tails between their legs, we're going to start having teenagers doing jobs again. And once
But excuse me, you're an effing white male. You're not allowed to speak.
Once teenagers work again, everything is going to be right with the world because they'll grow up to be normal entrepreneurs. Right now, we have these coddled kids that are growing up to hate entrepreneurs. They say, "You didn't build that. You got rich off of your daddy, or the government made you rich." No, idiot. I lost a fortune making this fortune.
Over and over again.
Over and over. There's so much abuse.
Listen,
in being
at least two-thirds of new things I launch fail, but I always come up with something new. And I just don't get people that just, like, sit there bitching all day. It's crazy.
Two-thirds of the world's billionaires got there on their own accord. You look at the top, Fortune's top 500, two-thirds of them were bootstrap billionaires. But we have this horrible mentality. Even when I'm watching shows with the kids, my kids, everything is, oh, he wanted money and he was evil and they wanted to do a commercial and money is evil. And you just think, stop brainwashing our kids to think money is wrong.
But meanwhile, the left has won all our money and increased taxes, though.
They keep going on Kickstarter and starting charities because they can't make their own money. And money is evil in Russia. Money is evil in China because if you got it, you stole it. Here in the free market, if you're rich, odds are you worked your ass off.
It means you created something new and people came to it. So Gavin McGinnis, let me ask you this question. In a world where the average liberal thinks Triceratops are being killed by Donald Trump Jr., is there any hope for them, or we just triage them and cut them off and then just, like, they kind of wander around like, you know, everybody's got kind of a lobotomized schizophrenic in their neighborhood that kind of just wanders around? I mean, how do we handle these people?
Most people are apolitical. I wish they wouldn't go to the polls. I mean, Obama became president out of spite by disgruntled spinsters, mostly cougars, angry women, voted for him out of spite, and they're the ones who put the election over the edge. Romney would have won if we had the voting demographics we had for Reagan. But we have these people forcing themselves into politics, the same way we have women forcing themselves into the workforce, pretending that they hate the kitchen, pretending they don't want to be housewives, pretending they don't want to be taken care of. It's all these fakes, these phonies, pretending they care about politics and the Trump kids. You don't care. You don't even know what a Triceratops is. So stop getting involved.
It's a racist, but expanding. Listen, I agree with you. The Democrats are horrible. Our big problem is the Republican Party's been just basically like them, corrupt, run by the same special interests. Trump has overthrown that with the populist movement. That's why the Republican establishment is against him. But what do we do about a Republican establishment that'll pretty much just go along with so much of this?
There's two worlds with your question, right? There's Trump winning and there's Trump not winning. If Trump wins, Guy Fawkes just got into the White House. He's lighting up the dynamite. Kaboom. It's a reboot on the whole system. It's a reboot on the control the lobbyists have. It's a reboot on all these earmarked.
And they know it.
All these favors, they know it. They know they're out of a job. That's why they hit it.
They've got a big fat dossier on Trump and know that he's been listening to certain shows every day for 10 years.
Right. Hillary Clinton is mentioning you now. Yeah, the Monaco Republicans know that their days are numbered, and that is heaven. Now, if Trump doesn't win and we're stuck with Hillary, what do we do? Well, we keep fighting. We keep doing shows like this. We keep getting the truth out. We keep spreading it.
I agree. Isn't it almost a bigger victory if they steal it and put her in? Because then they'll screw things up so bad, the victory against them will be 50 times bigger. I'm almost worried Trump gets in, they blame all the collapse that's already ongoing on him. But it won't matter because his supporters understand that and aren't dumb.
Yeah, I mean, Canada elected a guy with Down syndrome, Justin Trudeau. He's still, they still don't realize the mess they've made. They still watch the dollar plummet and blame it on other things. They still see terrorism happen on their soil. Two people killed in 1 week. And they say, no, it's nothing to do with the liberal system that we've brought upon ourselves with the CBC. I don't know how long it will take them to wake up, but the beauty of our crusade is we're telling the truth and lies run sprints. We'll run the marathon. And I think that it's inevitable that people come on board. Since even starting these Proud Boys thing, I can't tell you how many millennials, how many children of single mothers have come up to me, including housewives too. Housewives come up and go, you know, I grew up in a world where the family meant nothing, and I always suspected it was wrong. And the fact that you were out there venerating the entrepreneur, venerating the housewife, is making me realize I was being lied to all these years. I mean, in a way,
it's, and the truth is, she's just trying to pick up a guy that actually got something going on.
Exactly. It's sort of like selling pot in college.
Oh, look at these trendies who can't pick women up, and a guy that's a libertarian or conservative can't beat them off with a stick. And these guys are such losers, they double down on this liberal BS, and the women run from them. It's crazy, man.
Women love anyone who's libertarian, conservative, anyone who has the balls to fight, because it's a cave thing. They know that if they have young people, if they have babies in the cave, you need someone out there with a flaming stick, and that's who we are. You're out there with your flaming stick beating back the hounds, beating back the woolly mammoths that the Trump kids don't kill, and that is the future of America, no matter who gets elected.
Now, wait a minute. I saw it on the internet. You're saying they didn't kill Triceratops? Or woolly mammoths?
Some Triceratops. They're still running through the streets. They're still out there.
I got a photo of me out there, actually, with a woolly mammoth. I don't get off on how dumb Democrats are, but, I mean, I'm telling you, it is hilarious. You can have duality of mind. I feel sorry for the people, but I can't help it. It's still ridiculous how dumb they are, because they're always pseudo-intellectual. They always think they're smarter than you. And really, they're just idiots that were raised on TV that never lived out in the real world, like Gavin McInnes was just saying earlier. But here's the bottom line. It's a bunch of technocrats that want to have driverless cars, that want to have a nanny state where you can't, quote, do anything dangerous so that you can, quote, be controlled and dominated. They have a plan. And so, sure, their current political system is being rejected worldwide. Nationalism, populism is rising. Free marketism is rising. The male is returning to a certain extent. But don't count the globalists out. They're still pushing hard. But I got to tell you, it's very positive to see hackers across the world battling against Hillary, to see real liberals like Julian Assange coming out valiantly and exposing them. I mean, the world has really spoken, Gavin McInnes, against this system.
Yep. You know, one thing I think that a problem with our side is anonymity. We're so scared of losing our jobs. We're so scared of speaking out. We go to a dinner party. We know here in New York City, you're going to be the only Trump supporter at the table. And you just quietly sit there and chew your food and seethe. And I think that's really unhealthy. The thing I hate about that is now the thought police don't even have to show up because you're on autopilot. You're censoring yourself on your own time. So what I say to these people is go out there, get fired. Safety last. Don't wear a bicycle helmet. Say whatever is on your mind at all times. I don't care who records it, who doesn't record it.
Immediate safety loses the overall war. You only lose by trying to stay safe. I found you go out, these people are all in their own zombie land and will start admitting to you that they actually agree with you in most cases.
Yeah, it's not healthy. It's morally wrong. It sits there and it stews inside. You're probably giving yourself cancer by holding this in. Now, there's ways to do it. You got to show adrenaline control and not get into ad hominem attacks. I like to keep it interrogative here in New York and say, well, did Trump actually say that? Or did he just say a disproportionate number of Mexicans who cross the border tend to be rapists? And the secret here is we're not trying to segregate ourselves from everyone else. We're trying to spread the truth. And I think a big part of that is engaging.
Isn't it funny the Democrats now admit at colleges and stuff, they're promoting actual segregation?
Exactly. I mean, I start sounding like Glenn Beck when I say this, but I am into inclusion. I want everyone together on this, every race, every religion, every sexual preference, every gender. I want them to be on board with us and accept the fact that, hey, you are smart enough, you're good enough to do it on your own. You don't need the government. You don't need some incompetent bureaucrat with no incentive telling you how to live your life.
Who has no idea your background, where you're at exactly. I mean, I hardly know how to run my life, certainly not some faceless bureaucrat. In closing, Gavin, I want your prediction. I'm putting you on the spot. Trump, does he win? Does he lose? Do they steal it? Your prediction in 54 days, what happens?
Trump wins. We are literally dancing in the street like Muslims on 9/11. We can't believe how lucky we are. There is hysterical backlash a la Maggie Thatcher when she liberated England from their classism and gave them a middle class. There's going to be a lot of blaming going on, and eventually the left, maybe a year in, will realize that we were right in choosing Trump. And America focused on what it's best at, and that is liberty, prosperity, and freedom.
Innovation, true liberalism.
True liberalism. Yeah, we get that word back.
All right. Well, as long as we keep the Republicans honest and take that party fully over and then have a real challenge with libertarian liberals coming in the Democratic Party.
Yes.
It could happen.
It's going to be a massive cleanup. We'll reboot it and we'll update to America 2.0.
That's right. America 2.0. Gavin McGinnis, thank you so much for the time. Look forward to speaking to you, my friend.
Thanks for having me.
You bet. Wow. All right, that guy has got so many fans. It's exciting. We'll be back with the third hour.
Thank you.
He's an independent reporter for many years. We've been talking to him for more than 14 years. He's Mark Dice of MarkDice.com, best-selling author. Find his books at MarkDice.com. I want to, in this short segment, play part of the video that's up on Infowars.com of concerned Americans in San Diego, which is a more conservative area. In L.A., most of the people are actually unable to even really talk or find their ass with both hands. I'm not joking. We don't take pleasure in how dumbed down they are. We actually are trying to expose this so we can have a national debate about it. Now, Austin's a little bit better. Our liberals, only 9 out of 10 say put gun owners in forced labor camps. Only 9 out of 10 believe that dihydrogen monoxide should be banned or that, you know, the Trumps are killing dinosaurs. But they really believe woolly mammoths, saber-toothed tigers, I guess stegosauruses and triceratops that have been dead for millions of years are being killed by the Trumps. I'm going to show folks a document cam shot of a Photoshop that was circulating the web, and they're very, very upset about this. So we've got him coming up in the next segment, but let's play a few minutes of him talking to people that are very concerned and actually have the proper politically correct fashionable answers to why it's wrong to be killing dinosaurs that no living human has ever seen. Here it is. See that incredible stegosaurus? See that incredible?
You might have seen the Donald Trump kids are big hunters. They go on these hunting trips just for fun and kill these poor animals. So now, just getting people's reactions to Donald Trump's kids now killing the triceratops in Africa on a hunting expedition.
Okay, so honestly, my opinion is I think they're just getting away with a lot for the simple fact that they're Donald Trump's children.
Would an ordinary person be able to get away with killing a triceratops, or is the Donald Trump's kids just being able to get away with that because they're Donald Trump's kids?
I think they're getting away with it because they're Donald Trump's kids, and I think anybody else would just get in trouble, and they honestly just, I don't know,
with
jail
the
time.
Animal rights activists.
Yeah, they'll pay a fine for it, and they'll serve their time in jail and
for killing the triceratops. I think it's an endangered species in some countries, so it makes it even worse.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I agree.
All right, thank you very much. Triceratops is on the endangered species list. Now Donald Trump Jr., a big game hunter, just killed triceratops and posted a picture posing with the dead animal's body. Is that inappropriate? Is that the wrong thing to be doing?
I mean, yeah, definitely. That's very inappropriate. I mean, that's a bad example, obviously, to give to people around, especially for running for president, and your kids are out shooting
triceratops,
you know, animals. And
should we allow a president whose children are hunting triceratops to be in the White House?
Definitely not.
they trophy hunt things like lions and tigers and things like that. And now the Trump kids have killed a pterodactyl in their latest hunting expedition. Just getting people's comments on this. Is that inappropriate for them to be trophy hunting those things just for fun when it's not for meat?
I personally wish that people wouldn't do it, but at the end of the day, if there's a right to do it and there's a service that does it,
absolutely.
Dranosaurus, you get a permit to hunt the pterodactyls, so, I guess.
I don't approve of it. I don't like it, but if they can get a permit and they can do it legally, I guess.
How the hell do these people not want to know what a pterodactyl is?
Donald Trump's kids, Donald Jr. and Eric Trump, are big hunters, and they just killed a saber-toothed tiger.
Oh my gosh.
A lot of animal people, a lot of liberals are upset about that. Do you think that was wrong to kill the saber-toothed tiger?
I think it was probably because it's not a sustainable animal.
Extinct for 100,000 years.
Pretty rare.
Yeah, and it would end the, you know, what's the word for it?
They're an endangered species.
Endangered species. And then
we're
going to
break,
all folks.
This
species.
Is a serious broadcast. We've got pterodactyls. We've got woolly mammoths. We've got stegosaurus is under attack. The Trump children have a time machine. They're going back in time, and we finally found what extinct the dinosaurs. It was Donald J. Trump Jr., folks. Listen, I don't get the big deal from Mark Dice, political analyst, frequent contributor to Infowars.com. Behind us, we can actually put it on screen. That's a photo here in Texas just a few months ago. My buddy Q out on my ranch in East Texas, we were hunting velociraptors. I mean, I took two down. I had a tag for three. One of them I kind of wounded, but it got away. And I just don't get the criticism that we've seen out there of Donald J. Trump Jr. and Eric Trump for big game hunting. In fact, if you're a TV viewer, you can see this video. Liberals outraged after Trump kills Triceratops and a pterodactyl. And so Mark Dice went out, and he doesn't edit these videos other than to cut them down. This is who he talked to. Everybody he talked to in San Diego, black, white, Hispanic, old, young, they all believe that Triceratops still live, pterodactyls still live, velociraptors still live. I obviously did not kill a velociraptor 2 weeks ago. It's been reportedly extinct for 25 million years. Whether you believe in that time frame or not, point is, we don't see these things running around. So I'm going to finish up a clip of this just to illustrate, what do you do with people this dumbed down? Because we go out and 9 out of 10 people say, yeah, I say, Obama wants to ban the harmful chemical, or just the chemical, or the compound by hydrogen monoxide or sodium chloride. Dihydrogen monoxide's water, and of course, sodium chloride's table salt. And almost everyone says, oh, yeah, I want to ban it, including one guy hitting on McAdoo goes, yeah, I've got a chemistry degree from Cornell, baby. So it's like, what happened to their brains? Because they couldn't get, you know, in 100 years playing Jeopardy, they couldn't win one round. Who are these people? Are these the inheritance of the world? Now, we're going to talk Hillary and the latest emails and all the big stuff that's coming out. It's huge. One of our stories is a top story on DrudgeReport.com, the new emails of former Secretary of State Colin Powell, where he's talking about how sick Hillary is a year ago with Democratic donors. We're going to cover the waterfront, but finish up before we go to Mark Dice. Here's a little bit more, folks. It's, hey, maybe something 25 million years old. You can get it wrong with a Triceratops is. Even though that's the thing that everybody like age three knows what Triceratops is. It's the three big dinosaurs. The Stegosaurus, the Tyrannosaurus means terrible lizard in Latin. I even know that. And then, of course, the Triceratops, which means three-horned. But no. Then we get into woolly mammoths gone for 100,000 years. Then we get into saber-toothed big cats. So let's go ahead and finish up the clip.
We're just getting people's reactions now. Donald Trump's children are posting photos of them now. They had killed a woolly mammoth on a hunting expedition just for a trophy to mount the head in their Manhattan apartment. Just getting people's reactions to the Trump kids now killing a woolly mammoth.
I think it's awful that they're doing that and just thinking that it's okay just because they have lots of money that they can throw it away by, you know, taking part in these things, whereas I don't think it's okay that they're doing that.
Now Donald Trump's kids, Eric and Donald Jr., have killed a saber-toothed tiger just for fun. You may have seen the photos going around social media, just getting people's comments on that.
I don't think it's a right move. I mean, a saber-toothed tiger is a beautiful animal, and I mean, I'm sure it's an endangered species.
It's pretty rare.
If you want to, like, you know, go hunt something or kill something, why don't you go fish or something? You know what I mean? Or, I mean, I don't know. I don't believe killing anything's right, personally.
Especially a saber-toothed tiger.
Oh, yeah. That's so rare. I mean, the only reason they're doing it is because they have the money to do it, and, you know, I guess...
And that's what these rich people do for fun. They go and kill these saber-toothed tigers and woolly mammoths, and even, I think, a pterodactyl they had killed once, too.
I think it's inappropriate, and, you know, we'll see what happens.
You may have saw on social media today... Donald Trump's kids are big hunters. They go in Africa and hunt exotic animals.
Okay.
Now Donald Trump's kids have shot and killed a woolly mammoth. A lot of people are outraged
about this, just getting people's comments on. You have a nice, attractive, probably 30-year-old woman wearing lingerie and a leather jacket walking around. Beautiful beach, this great heaven of a free market society. I guarantee you she wants my guns. I guarantee you. If she thinks I'm a racist, I guarantee you she's living in this la-la land heaven compared to North Korea, and she's worried about dinosaurs that the Trumps are killing. So I don't hate this woman. I don't call her deplorable, but what do you do with the magnitude we're dealing with of idiocy? Let's finish up and go to Mark Dice.
Donald Trump Jr. and Eric Trump killing this woolly mammoth just as a trophy for fun.
Well, I honestly think it's wrong. First of all,
mainly because
if you are going to be the future president and you're trying to put an example to the world, humanity is so evolved in only focusing on the materialistic things that we're living nowadays.
And you shouldn't be hunting woolly mammoths.
So materialistic.
No, of course not.
So transcendent. Okay, that's enough. I'm going to go to Mark Dice. It's just we're illustrating this, not to make fun of them, but to understand. They tell these folks that Donald Trump's a racist. They tell these people that Donald Trump is supporting ISIS when Hillary created it. And they're so uninformed, they believe it. And that's the genius of what Mark Dice does and what jaywalking did and what we do, is to illustrate this horror. What's scary is, Mark, you don't have to even go out all day to find these people. This is who you interviewed. I mean, I know your methodology. It's ours as well. When you have people that know what a Triceratops is, you'll show it. What planet are we living on?
And those are only about half the people that you saw. I try to keep the videos about 3 minutes because it helps with the ratings. A lot of times people shut a video off after 3 or 4 minutes.
Sure. So you're saying you had even more that didn't know what a Triceratops was.
I always have more in the weekly Man on the Street Monday segments. Yes. And the reason I got this idea is because a couple years ago there was a story going around. Somebody posted a photo of Steven Spielberg sitting with an animatronic Triceratops from the original Jurassic Park. And they joked and they said, hey, you know, Steven Spielberg has, killed this poor animal. And it started being spread around Facebook. And there were a lot of people. It made national headlines that people were outraged about, you know, some supposed hunter. They didn't even know who Steven Spielberg was. They saw a photo of what looked to be a dead Triceratops and a guy sitting there in front of it. They thought that he had killed it. So I decided, again, let's go and test this, as we've been doing here on my YouTube channel for, I don't know, 10 years. I mean, weekly for 3 years. And this is the level of insanity. And sometimes the video is a little redundant because I want to make sure.
Folks, no, you're not just picking and choosing here. This is California.
Southern California is a very special animal. I think we're one of the sources, one of the centers.
No, it's the only place dumber than Austin.
Now, I want to make clear, the videos can be a little redundant because I want to make sure that people know that there's no deceptive editing, where I want you to see that I'm asking them the question, I'm getting their full comments. Easily, I could cut and splice people answering different questions for different things, and it would be dishonest. So I want people to see, these are the people, these are the questions. I mentioned it, you can hear it 3 times for most of these. I try to repeat myself 3 times.
You say again, it's terrible, you know, the Triceratops, they're killing.
This is amazing.
You should go next level, though, next time, and then confront them and go, but I don't know, it'd be a longer video, and say, you know, that's a dinosaur that's, sorry, folks, that's 25 million years ago. That's when the dinosaurs ended, supposedly with the comet or whatever they think. The Triceratops was 68 million years ago. So excuse me, but we'll put it back on screen for TV viewers. and I'll give folks the definition of a Triceratops and that entire family, but 68 million years ago, Triceratops is a genus of a herbivore cerastopod, if I can read that from a distance, dinosaur, that first appeared during the stage of the late Cretaceous period, 68 million years ago, in what is now North America. It is one of the last known avian dinosaur genera and became extinct in the Cretaceous extinction 66 million years ago, and it just goes on from there. I mean, what the hell is wrong with these people?
Well, I'll tell you, a couple weeks ago, I did a segment where I asked people what city Donald Trump is from, what city is he best known for, where does he live? I mean, hardly anybody knew, Alex, and we target millennials. We target people under 30. It's a college town. And
yeah, but you also target some 50, 60-year-olds.
These people who hate Donald Trump, who think he's a racist, they don't even know what city he's best known for being associated with. I mean, as a kid who grew up in the 80s, I knew probably when I was 7 or 8 years old that Donald Trump is some rich guy from New York City. He has something to do with real estate. They have no idea what region of the country he lives in. Don't know. They don't even know that really one of the most famous, if not the most famous New Yorker. They don't even know that he's from New York.
He's probably the most famous New Yorker, hands down.
Yeah, they know nothing about him. And, you know, a lot of the stuff that we've talked about over the last 10 years that you've been covering for probably 20, that was laughed at. You know, you and Gavin McGinnis were talking about this. It was laughed at, ridiculed. And now people are finally taking it serious, or the establishment is trying to hijack it and spin it. Now, instead of the establishment hacking the elections, which you were warning about back in 2004 or many others, now they're just trying to blame the Russians. Like, the idiocracy.
Yeah, now they say, okay, the election will be staged, but Putin's running it, and Putin has poisoned Hillary. That's the Washington Post. Talk about conspiracy theorists.
Even Jimmy Kimmel is admitting that the conspiracy theories about Hillary's health are true. The mainstream media is eating crow because it's so undeniable. And if that
so that's my next question. They're collapsing credibility. Where do they go from here?
I don't even know. It's a really exciting time to be alive, and we're on the verge of either a complete renaissance or finally plunging off the cliff, because if Hillary wins, Hollywood often sets the society agenda, sets the moral agenda, but Washington backs it legally. And so we're going to have, if Hillary wins, we're going to have the backing of the Justice Department to promote all of this complete insanity about the transgender bathrooms.
And they're pissed. They know they're losing. It's going to be vengeance.
And we're seeing every day now, as we're in the final stretch of the election here, in the final 50-some days, it's getting so dirty. The dirty tricks are coming out.
Oh, and they're licking their chops, Mark, to take our rights. I want to talk about Facebook and Instagram have recently censored, deleted your videos, many others. They admit they're doing it. Massive new censorship. We're seeing things to come if they win. As you said, off the cliff of renaissance. I'm betting on renaissance. We'll look at the Jimmy Kimmel thing you mentioned. We have that clip. We'll look at Fox News apologizing to Margaret for claiming on air that he ripped off Jesse Waters. Stay with us. I want to go back to this paradox where I don't think Jimmy Kimmel is part of the New World Order. He just has Hillary on. They basically have a script that's written and they go with it. And then he says, well, we didn't hear a pop with Hillary. Let's see if it pops with Wolf Blitzer. And it pops. And they go, okay, then I guess it's true. I mean, to their credit, when it's proven that a pickle jar doesn't open in a circle like peanut butter, a pickle jar, it doesn't. It opens with a pop. It's vacuum sealed. Mark Dice was the guy that pointed it out first. I gave him credit. I went and did it here on air. They made a huge national story. I mean, thousands of newspapers, CNN, Fox News, CBS, NBC making fun of me until everybody started calling in. The majority of comments were like, yeah, pickle jars open with a pop. 1 millimeter. Boop. And so then they do it. They go, okay, it pops, but then they go to break. Well, now it comes out that she's falling down. She's collapsing. He actually plays the video, unlike other media that wouldn't show the collapse. They just show her wobbling and say we're discredited because they understand they're not going to sell out their audience and what viewers they have left just to appease the system. There comes a point where it's self-destructive to serve the New World Order. And I think we've reached that demarcation line. Here's Kimmel last night.
You probably know Hillary was coughing a lot in public last week, and then yesterday she was forced to leave a 9/11 memorial because she was feeling faint. Turns out on Friday, Clinton's doctor had diagnosed her with pneumonia, but they kept it secret until this happened, and they were forced to admit it. You know, these conspiracy theories about Hillary Clinton's health would be a lot harder to believe if they didn't actually come true. Or maybe, just maybe, there's another story here. Well, let's run the video where she had to be helped into the van. You probably saw this on the news. Now, this is just...
No, you didn't, because they don't show the full thing.
We see she's being kind of supported by one of her handlers there. And then she stumbles a little bit, and they actually, Secret Service has to kind of put her into the van. They even get in between her and the news cameras. But I tell you, maybe Hillary Clinton doesn't have pneumonia. Maybe Hillary Clinton had a few too many shots of Trump vodka the night before.
Okay, then they play a video of her slowing down. Okay, that's enough. Going back to Mark Dice, longer segment coming up. You'll be able to break this down. But right now, Alex Witt is just one we've played. But you saw it. We saw it. Every channel, they first ignored it Sunday. Monday, they would just show her wobbling and then cut it and say, oh, we're liars. She didn't fall down. Again, in a vacuum, thinking their viewers wouldn't see the full fall down that even Kimmel understood he had to show. I mean, it seems like we've reached a point where people get it.
Yeah, and the media is so deceptive that it's thankfully we have organizations like you and platforms like YouTube to expose them, because CNN, social media, Facebook, they're all in on the manipulation. Just last week, I was going back and forth with Jake Tapper on Twitter. He's the CNN chief Washington correspondent, about their deceptive reports about Trump appearing on Russian television when they omitted that he was really just talking with former face of CNN, Larry King. And so I was going back and forth with him on Twitter, and he finally admitted, well, that's a good point. I guess we probably should have mentioned that it was, you know, Larry King, former CNN. So I did a video just about me taking him to the woodshed and about how deceptive they are. That video on YouTube got 200,000 views. That's more viewers than CNN has on some of their shows.
That's right.
Greta Van Susteren just quit Fox News. She did her first Facebook Live broadcast immediately afterwards. She was stunned that a million people tuned in. And so she follows me on Twitter. We were chatting back and forth on Twitter about the new media. And she, much to her credit, now she's finally realizing the power of the new media.
The illusion is falling that Drudge for a decade has said, wait till it falls. It's happening. I mean, I'm not bragging, folks. We reach 30-something million people a week now. It was 28 million a month ago. I'm not bragging. That's bigger than CNN. They just don't get it.
Former Fox News host Greta Van Susteren is now stunned. She's finally catching up to the technology and realizing that from her kitchen she can reach as many people or more as she could on a big
show. And people want her from the kitchen. They're sick of the fake garbage.
And that's why I just turned down another offer to host a major show on a major network, because I'm not going to be told what to do. You know, I've had meetings with these big networks, and I see how this system works. And I don't sign contracts.
Absolutely. Listen, you sell your soul. You get the money, but they then control you.
They control you. They control what you can and can't say. I mean, just when I was in negotiations or just pitching shows last year, I had the producers who meant well, different than the networks themselves, the production company. They started going through some of my videos and some of my tweets, and they were getting worried. Oh, can you delete this video? This might be seen as sexist. And I mean, it's just incredible.
Now, you enter the mind-controlled prison that they're in, and you realize these are people, victims.
They are. They've signed contracts, I mean, you know, figuratively in blood, but they can't talk about certain things. They have, even Megyn Kelly, she has to wear the clothes. She had to wear those funny eyelashes during one of the debates, which made headlines because they were Betty Boop style, bizarrely big. And she has no control
over
that. Oh,
my God. I can't even follow my own directives I give myself, much less somebody else's. I'm completely out of control, and thank God. We'll be back. All right. Mark Dice is our guest, markdice.com. I want to cover the waterfront with him with a bunch of news articles. If you want to call in briefly with a question or comment for Mark Dice, the guy that goes out and talks to the Southern Californians that are in another world, the toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. Paul Joseph Watson from Her Britannic Majesty's London will be hosting the fourth hour today, always informative, always riveting. Before we go any further, the storable food special wasn't in yesterday, but our new special wasn't ready to launch today, so we're going to keep it one more day, but it's gone tomorrow. 30 to 40% off all the super high quality storable foods. For the price, it is the best tasting, highest quality you're going to find. There are some things less price out there, but it's like eating, you know, brick siding or sheetrock. This stuff is high quality, tasty, very consumable. A lot of it delicious, but I mean, it's high quality is the point. What I've chosen for my family, for the price, you're not going to find anything even half as good. InfoWarsStore.com or call toll free 888-253-3139. And I don't claim to be Mr. Universe, okay? I gained almost 100 pounds of fat for over a decade, not exercising, fighting the New World Order. It's taken me many years to lose close to 60, 70 pounds. But I gained back some of the muscle I had. But I'm showing photos for TV viewers of myself just 4 years ago and just last week. I mean, that's what 70 pounds of fat off of you and a bunch of muscle I gained looks like. There I am 3-4 years ago at Bilderberg in London. This was about 4 years ago. And here I am just about a month or two ago on vacation at the beach. I mean, I've always been a stocky big guy, at least since I was about 15 or 16. But the point is that it's massive, and it's the X2 Survival Shield True Iodine. It's getting the proper vitamins and minerals and things through the Vitamin Mineral Fusion Fruit Punch drink from InfoWarsLife.com. This is what's really turned my life around. We have new BioTru Selenium in right now. We have Brain Force, super high-quality nootropic. Look how we know the info. Look how we have the experts. Look at how we're always on the cutting edge. We've done that now with over 25 products in the 4 years of InfoWarsLife.com. You can also call toll-free to ask about any specials or to order 888-253-3139. But Supermel Vitality, Superfemal Vitality are concentrated, cold-pressed herbs, so you get the full effect. Now, we sell Anthroplex, that is the poor man's super male. It's only like $15 less, but it's a bigger dose. It's dry. It comes from fresh organic herbs. It's got a lot of the same herbs, but it's not cold pressed. It's excellent, and it kind of is a platform for super male or female. But just try it out for yourself. I mean, quite frankly, I'll just wait and see what happens. I'm going to stop right there. It's just that plants, ladies and gentlemen, are the original. The big pharma is trying to copy what the plants are able to do. So your support makes it all possible. Going back to Mark Daish, Mark, looking at all this, where would you, I mean, you already talked about it, but I keep going back to this. Their system is collapsing so fast in front of us. We have state-run Russian TV saying, basically the mouth of Putin saying, his best buddy saying, you know, they're going to try to kill Trump. I see that as their only move. They're so desperate, but then Hillary and her low energy and all of her corruption seems to be emblematic of how this system is on its last leg.
You know, it's very exciting because we're right on the verge. Like I said, either a renaissance or we're going off the cliff. And we're seeing so many people that are waking up, so much that you've been reporting, that Matt Drudge has been reporting for over a decade, finally getting recognized. And it's so undeniable that the mainstream media has to cover it. But we're also seeing that the censorship and the manipulation still quite powerful, things that we've been warning about and documenting for years still happening now that most people, the young people at least, rely on social media for their news. Things that we were talking about the trending topics being manipulated, finally being confirmed, making its way into the mainstream
media. The internet's being handed over to the UN in 1 month.
But it's still happening. I mean, I just last week, I had several Instagram posts removed and a Facebook post removed for what they said were terms of service.
So the censorship is intensified. So what do? We speak out for freedom, congressional hearings, but we also support independent platforms like DrudgeReport.com, InfoWars.com, MarkDaish.com. More than ever, that's the last phase to get censored. People who bitch at us all day and say, do your own thing. We are. We try to go and spread it all for free to wake people up on the big social networks, but we need people to support the actual original platforms.
Yeah, and you know, things that we've been doing and talking about for years are happening. YouTube demonetizing sensitive content finally made mainstream news, but this is something that I've been dealing
with. That's social engineering. They've openly announced the Chinese-style model well, explain to people.
Well, we had been dealing with this for over a year, a lot of alternative media on YouTube where they would just turn off ads, they would demonetize videos, they would remove them saying it's just sensitive content. It's not advertiser friendly. And this is literally over a year ago. And finally, after a big YouTuber had one of his videos demonetized, he raised awareness about this. It was a top trend on Twitter. Hashtag YouTube is over party. And so people were finally talking about this. But literally, this has been happening for over a year. So even the top trend on Twitter, the mainstream media, they're a year behind. And so, you know, we've been talking about Facebook censoring. I've had it happen multiple times.
We've had them censor us and suspend us for days routinely. Let me show people a Bloomberg article. Publishers may get paid for web news as EU swipes at Google. When Drudge links to your page, you do backflips. But no, they're bitching. They say when Drudge or anybody else links to them, they want you to pay for linking and sending them traffic. This is incredible. This is how they want to censor. This is in the TPP.
And there's no appeal process on Facebook. They just deleted the post. They wouldn't let me log in. They logged me out, and they just simply had an OK button, and they said, you violated our terms of service.
OK.
And you must approve, you must agree that you did, or you can't log in and you can't use it.
And they know that Pavlovianly you're going to agree to be able to even get into your stuff.
Yeah, there was no appeal process. They didn't even send an email. Instagram didn't even send an email showing which post was removed. I just happened to notice it because it was the most recent one.
Sure, so that's Kafka-esque. They won't even tell you what you've done wrong.
No, and it gets even worse. Then I posted a screenshot on my Instagram. So I don't really use Instagram much. I'm more of a YouTube guy and Facebook guy. But I took a screenshot of the notification of the violation, which didn't even show the meme that was deleted, which I'll tell you about. It's certainly not even offensive. It was quite funny and very relevant. So I posted a screenshot saying, hey, guys, they've removed my post denouncing discrimination against white people regarding the black-only dorms and the black segregation, black safe spaces. So Instagram gave me another strike, Alex, and they deleted that.
And let's expand on that. It's that it's indefensible to call for white and black segregation. If you want to do it on your own, that's your issue. But the point is that this is like saying, I won't hire anybody who's Hispanic or I won't hire anybody who's Asian. It's super racist. It's wrong. I'll hire who's capable and get the job done. I don't care what color you are. But you're pointing out that all over the country, colleges are officially segregating again, and then you're the racist.
And I posted another meme. It just simply showed a 1950s cartoon character, and it said, only we can call each other cracker. And it's referring to the controversy about how black people and the social justice warriors get really offended if a white person says, I don't even think it's really the N-word, because the N-word has an ER on the end. But if they simply quote or sing along to rap songs that have a certain other word that starts with an N and ends with an A, people get all offended. So I posted this meme and it said, hey, only we can call each other cracker. Just kind of making fun of the double standard. Both Instagram and Facebook deleted that post as well.
Well, there's no doubt that they're pushing censorship now because they're losing the information war. And I don't just say this because I want to be self-serving or, you know, because I want to win and basically have hopeful thinking, wishful thinking. I don't see them ever getting away with this. Their whole globalist plan, no matter how technocratic, no matter how centralized, is dead on arrival, Mark. I mean, I really am very, very positive. People know I've been very, very negative a decade ago or even 4 or 5 years ago. I'm very, very positive right now. We've got some bad water to go through, you know, big storm. There's going to be some problems, but that which doesn't kill us only makes us stronger. I think as things sit right now, these people are in deep crap.
Well, look, when they banned Milo Yiannopoulos from Twitter, they just created perhaps thousands and thousands of Milo clones, people who use his profile picture and name their Twitter account Milo. And so they just
I am Spartacus. You kill Spartacus in the slave rebellion in Italy, and then you create 50,000 Spartacuses.
They just gave birth to them. And the more they try to hate us, it only makes us more powerful. I was trending on Twitter for the first time after the DNC because I posted a joke about Michelle Obama. I simply posted a picture and I said, hey, how nice of them to, you know, include a transgender speaker at the DNC. Very, very progressive. And I was trending on Twitter from tens of thousands of people calling for me to be banned from Twitter. And all they did is introduce me to more people. And so the more they try to stop us at this point, their tactics are so ineffective. And since we have the truth on our side, since we are backed by the Constitution, since we have so many people that we have each other's back, that if they try to take one of us down, everybody
and
else.
And that's the key. We have to keep, people say, oh, I fought censorship and won, but I won't do it over and over again. It's the animating contest of liberty. You have to fight and fight and fight and fight and fight. That's what it's all about, like breathing. Breathing is part of living. It's not a job. This is what makes us strong. The evil we have to oppose is what makes us strong. Let's go to Kyle in Canada. You're on the air with Mark Dice of MarkDice.com. Go ahead, Kyle.
Hi, Mark. My question is, I was just wondering, I live in Canada, so I was kind of surprised by the answers you get out of those Californians, but I'm just wondering if you think that the people in those videos agree because you're appearing to be a source of a media outlet, or are they just really that ignorant?
That's a good point. I mean, a lot of them are just doing it to agree, but it shows their mind control. Go ahead, Mark.
It's both. It's, you know, different segments. I'll sort of highlight the different aspects of his question. So it is both. Many of them don't have any idea what's going on. That's clear from their answers. Many of them also, because I appear to be an authority figure, because I have a...
By the way, recap it for new listeners. We have new listeners every second. You were out there in San Diego. Everybody you talked to said the Trump sons are bad for hunting pterodactyls and triceratops, extinct dinosaurs. So I don't think, yeah. I mean, I think sometimes they might go along with you just to seem friendly. But with this, no, I'd say, dude, that's extinct. There's no way he's hunting dinosaurs.
Now, so, yeah, what I do is I tell people, you know, fake news stories. And I think that Jimmy Kimmel has sort of put his own spin on it and made it into a segment, Lie Witness News, which is kind of a similar thing to what I do, which I believe is just a copy of what I was doing, my own spin on Jay Leno's jaywalking. But, you know, the latest segment last week on my YouTube channel, I told people that the Trump kids were, you know, hunting pterodactyls and they killed triceratops. And this is, you know, is this an outrage? Is this acceptable? Should they be punished? And a lot of people thought, yeah, you know, this is terrible. This is wrong. You shouldn't be hunting endangered species. So to answer Kyle's question, because I have a microphone, I have a symbol of power, because I appear to be an authority figure, I represent the, you know, the media, the agenda, what is right. I pretend to
so
be.
So it illustrates the mind control one way or the other. Kyle, anything else?
No, that was all I was really thinking. Yep.
Thank you. Yeah, I think sometimes it's the authority figure thing, but most of the time, I mean, he'll go, so put gun owners in a forced camp. He goes, yeah, I'm sick of them. It's like some old white professor guy, you know, and these people are very dangerous. Let's go ahead and talk to Mike in Oregon. You're on the air with Mark Dice. Go ahead.
Hey, guys. We're both watching, or all of us are watching the same thing, and we got like a punch-drunk boxer and Hillary up against the ropes. And pretty much it's like the Rocky IV movie. They're just refusing to throw in their white towel, and I'm not sure if somebody's going to get hurt or not, because it's pretty sad at this point watching and then everyone's standing by and basically like, oh, she's fine. She's going to get there and everything. But I just want you guys to answer this, because where is Bill in all this? He's never there. I never see him at any of her speeches or get-togethers or anything.
Well, that's a great question, Mike. I appreciate you bringing that up to Mark Dice. I mean, for me, Mr. Dice, Bill looks like he's even sicker than Hillary, and half the time can't seem to string a sentence together.
You know, I think they're separating them because they don't want to give the impression that it's going to be a third term for Clinton. So they're trying to have the two Clintons be completely separate entities. And by having him be along by her side, it's going to appear as if it's Bill that's running. And so they're trying to really create the distinction between Bill and Hillary, keeping him in the background. And you might have already covered this. The CBS edited out him admitting that she frequently passes out.
You know, since you raised that, it's a big deal. In fact, I have the clip of Alex Witt, too. We'll play after the break. For TV viewers, it's obviously more powerful than radio listeners. Radio listeners can't see it, which is why I brought TV to radio 18 years ago. I would say stuff, people didn't believe it, so I started not just webcamming, but actually showing people the articles and video live on air and kind of pioneering this genre. That's why they say necessity is the mother of invention. But again, they go, she didn't fall down. Look at the video. And it's just her stumbling. But next, she falls on her face. Such deception. And like you said, Mark, they're in their own bubble. They don't know everyone's hating them, even though the studies show 6% of the people trust the mainstream media. Does the mainstream media, Mark Dice, know what jokes they are?
No, they're desperate. They're trying. I mean, they literally have fewer viewers than many YouTube channels. It's quite obvious, especially with when we can share through social media original clips like the CBS clip showing Clinton admit that she, quote, frequently passes out. And then CBS for the evening news later that day edits it around.
So she infrequently, let's go to that clip right now. Here it is.
When you look at that collapse, that video that was taken, you wonder if it's not more serious.
No,
than dehydration.
She's been, if it is, it's a mystery to me and all of her doctors, because rarely, but on more than one occasion over the last many, many years, the same sort of things happened to her when she just got severely dehydrated.
Now the edit where they cut it out. This is how dumb I think you are.
No, she...
And dehydration.
She's been... if it is, it's a mystery to me and all of her doctors. Rarely, but on more than one occasion over the last many, many years, the same sort of things happened to her when she just got severely dehydrated.
We'll be back after the break and play Alex Witt saying she didn't fall down. She's doing great. Look, and then they cut when she falls down. I mean, wow, this is... Understand. All right, and that's what's happening. Here is Alex Witt, this lady on MSNBC. And she's just emblematic. And I just picked one of many where they would show, well, she stumbled, and they don't show her falling down. Then we show it. Imagine. I mean, I couldn't imagine as a talk show host, keeping the truth straight is hard and all the facts. I couldn't imagine like trying to lie and keep it all straight. I mean, wow, yeah, no rest for the wicked is true. And then knowing that tens of millions had already seen this online and then cutting it, this is an arrogant creature. Let's play the clip for TV viewers. Radio listeners, I've already described it, but here it is.
What we will see here now is her getting into the car. She was a little bit unstable there. She was a little bit wobbly. That's, I think, an appropriate word to use. You can see right there.
So they just cut, Mark. This is the essence of these people.
Her MSNBC doctor who was saying that she's perfectly healthy. This just looks like a little dehydration. Wouldn't recommend. And you can, sometimes you just instinctively know when someone is lying. And to see this doctor who has taken the oath in order to help people be healthy and not lie about their health, lying on television was just absolutely incredible. Yeah, they cut the clip, they deceptively edit, they re-edited the Bill Clinton clip. They even cut him out for one of the segments, like rubbing on his face as soon as he was asked the question, all nervous about, he can't believe that he's being asked this question. It's an exciting time, but it's still an uphill battle. And it's we see every day as the election approaches, the smears are going to get worse and worse. So we have to remain vigilant. It's an exciting time. I mean, I tell you, I'm up till 3 o'clock in the morning every night working and writing and putting together stuff. And I
Me
know
too.
That you are too. It's really incredible.
54 days. I think they're going to try to steal the election. I think that's going to be their move, not kill Trump. Because if they kill Trump, it's too obvious. They may still do that, but I think it's still the election.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, there have been documentaries about how easy it is to hack the electronic voting machines. And of course, the establishment was saying that that was just a conspiracy theory 10 years ago and even 4 years ago. But now that it looks like Trump has the possibility of actually winning, it looks like they may actually be using this as a cover to actually go in and then hack the machines under the disguise of attempting to try to prevent
Absolutely.
It.
So, let's throw in a call from Tim in Wyoming and do 5 more minutes if you can. Talk to a few other callers before Paul Watson takes over. Tim, you got a question for Mark Dice. Go ahead and get it in.
Yes. Hi, Mr. Hi, thanks for taking my call. I appreciate it. Mr. Dice, I have a question for you. I'm from Northern California. I never found as many stupid people as you seem to find in Southern California. It's incredible. What's the percentage you'd say of people that are actually awake and have a living brain in their heads?
He's showing who he talks to. I mean, Mark?
5%, if that. I mean, it's we're at like a 70 or 80% ratio of people who will fall for or believe or give idiotic comments in the videos. It's astounding. I mean, every day after a shoot, and we'll go
Yeah, folks, you have to understand, we're not cherry-picking turds here. This is, in Austin, it's like just as almost as bad.
No, many of the episodes, nobody calls me out. I mean, just it's like shooting fish in a barrel. It's sad. It might be a Southern California thing. I've been in Northern California, a very nice place. People a lot more informed and educated.
That's right. Stay there, Tim. I'm going to have you have a comeback with Mark Dice. We're back in 70 seconds. Fourth hour. Some stations don't carry it. They should. We love them. Infowars.com/show. Fourth hour. Paul Watson coming up. 5 more straight ahead with myself and Mark Dice. You want to stop tyranny? Well, so does he. He's Mark Dice. And I'm Alex Jones, your host. Tim in Wyoming, finish up your point with Mark Dice. Go ahead.
Yes, Alex, I wanted to say that, as I say, the percentage of people.
All right, well, his phone just cut out. Go ahead again.
Hello.
Yeah, you got call waiting. You got somebody calling. You want to flip over and talk to him?
Actually, I don't. I'm.
All right, well, go ahead and ask your question. Go ahead and ask your question.
The question was, are people mostly waking up, or are they mostly going back to sleep or staying asleep?
Well, I think a lot of folks are waking up, but it doesn't count. The ones going back to sleep don't count. So, Mark, you agree with that, or what do you say?
Yeah, we just saw a report that says that many millennials are conservative. So I think there's finally a growing backlash because, you know, instinctively, many of them are probably looking around and realizing that there's something seriously wrong with this liberal progressive agenda, and they're looking for answers. So it's good that we're here to provide them with a direction sign to conservatism and towards true liberty. Sure. And true libertarianism. So it's a very exciting time to be alive. It's amazing to see what InfoWars has done. Now we have Hillary Clinton targeting Alex Jones. And it's really
well, the worm
insane.
Has turned, Mark, and all of us are in this together, and people can find your great books at markdice.com. Thank you so much, Mark. We'll talk to you soon. Keep it up.
Thank you.
Feels good to know there's folks like Mark out there taking action. His newest book, The Bohemian Grove, Facts and Fiction, Inside the Illuminati, you name it, markdice.com. And by the way, I wasn't poo-pooing the caller from Wyoming or Montana. I just get frustrated when the phones are having problems. Look. It's not that conservatism is perfect and who runs that and the different groups that are involved. It's that the Democratic Party, liberalism, socialism, communism, is dehumanization, is a plan to make you dependent, is a plan to consolidate control, is a plan to monopolize the human species itself. I mean, I've got the articles right here where, Uber wants to replace all human drivers in major cities within 5 years. That's their plan. And whether it's feasible or not, they're coming after us. They want control. They want to make us absolutely servile. The technocracy is the system of control. It doesn't empower. It dehumanizes. And so that's what I'm criticizing. That's what I'm speaking up against. That's what I'm fighting as hard as I can. And so it isn't just that, the Republicans and, Trump are going to save us. It's that Trump and the libertarian constitutionalist movement took over the Republicans, so the establishment took the libertarians over to try to confuse the public. And that's what's really going on. I know we've got HB and we've got Janice and Jesse and Greg and everybody else, but I'm out of time. Paul Watson's taken over. If he's able to take your calls, we can ask him if he wants to take the calls, but that's up to him. If not, please call us back tomorrow with the weekday show, 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Central. But the fourth hour I've added in the last year is our different hosts and writers and researchers taking turns hosting the show. Sometimes it's a round table. Sometimes I co-host it. Sometimes it's somebody all by themselves like Paul Watson. But Paul, the entire InfoWars operation is not second fiddle to anybody in the work he's doing. And it's providence, it's history that Paul is part of this operation. Just like seeing our information magnified with Drudge or magnified with you out there is very, very humbling. And I take that as a great responsibility. I do the very best job I can. A lot of times before the show, I get so overheated and so focused that I get angry because it's the responsibility of what we're facing. I don't even feel worthy of this. But you know what? We're not even so called judged by who we've been in our lives, but we're judged by, in the totality of it, by the times we were in and what we faced. So many great people are made by the circumstances they were in, not even so much where they came from or who they were. And so I try to control myself and not get too freaked out and too angry at myself for not doing the best job and not having all the answers in this place I am. But it's better than the globalists that are just totally arrogant and only think they have to show up in Louisiana during a flood or show up in Mexico and just, sit there and talk about jobs for Americans while they do everything they can to screw us. And I can tell you right now, I oppose those people that are out to make us poor and dumbed down. I want to make us wealthy and powerful and a free, open society. I stand for Renaissance, not for slavery. All right, there's 55 minutes left in transmission. Paul Watson's coming in out of the gate. He's hot. He's focused. He's ready. He's free.
We are back on the Alex Jones Show Live. It's Paul Joseph Watson. It's the fourth hour live, and we've got a huge raft of news to get to. Mainly going to concentrate on media hoaxes. Of course, we had CBS News edit an interview with Bill Clinton. We're going to get to this clip later, where he says openly that Hillary frequently collapses. Of course, in the final broadcast, they edited out the word frequently and just called it a little Freudian slip, and the viewing public of millions didn't hear it. Another brazen example of media censorship. And now we've also got CNN. We're going to get to this soon as well. Not challenging a guest who said 10 million Americans get pneumonia every week. Of course, they were trying to downplay Hillary Clinton's health problems by saying pneumonia was completely common. 10 million Americans get pneumonia every week. Of course, that's mathematically impossible because there are only about 350 million people living in America. If 10 million people got pneumonia in America every week, that would be 520 million people a year. So again, they're trying to conflate pneumonia with the flu, which of course is extremely more common. And now Bill Clinton's come out and give a speech, we're going to get to this as well, where he says that Hillary Clinton has the flu. Oh, that's funny. I thought her campaign said she had pneumonia. Now it's the flu. Because if they frame it as she's just got the flu, it can seem like a common occurrence. It can seem like not so much a big of a deal. So they can't even keep up with the lies anymore. It's getting completely out of control. We're going to get to those clips later on in the show. But let's start off with this. Top headline up at Infowars.com. Hillary Clinton sends thank you letter to, quote, slut who is proud of her sexually transmitted disease. Again, this is not The Onion. Hillary Rodham Clinton actually sent a letter saying that this woman was, quote, courageous for starting a campaign celebrating and telling women, young women, to embrace the fact that they have sexually transmitted diseases. Again, this is not a joke. This is not The Onion. This was a real story. In fact, I made a video about this when it first came out back in April. This feminist, of course she's a feminist, of course. And imagine my shock, gender studies graduate, Ella Dawson, came out with this internet campaign back in April called Shout Your Status, in which she encouraged young women to embrace their STDs, arguing that there shouldn't be any social stigma surrounding the issue. Listen to her tweet from back when she launched this campaign. Quote, I'm a slut and I have herpes. I'm still a person who deserves respect. So she launched this campaign on the basis of calling herself a slut and saying that having herpes should be celebrated. And then what happened? Well, lo and behold, like all social justice warriors, like all feminists, they spout absolute stupidity and then claim victimhood status when they get any kind of blowback. And in many cases, you know, go on to make a career out of being a victim. So they never have to get a proper job. So they can be like Anita Sarkeesian and Zoe Quinn and solicit millions of dollars to make videos about, you know, how video games are sexist and evil and get in front of the UN and call for free speech to be shut down on the basis of cyberbullying, which in their own words is people saying, you suck. And that's basically what happened in this case with Ella Dawson. She started this campaign. I made a video about it saying it was completely ridiculous because being a slut and having herpes isn't an accomplishment. You know, Milo Yiannopoulos of Breitbart tweeted about it. Lo and behold, what a surprise. She got criticized. Well, my God, the special snowflake actually got criticized for claiming that being a slut was a form of activism. So she got criticized. What did she do? She immediately reverted to victimhood status and tried to solicit sympathy out of it. Of course, she was a vehement Hillary Clinton supporter from the very beginning. That's to be expected. But she wrote an essay recently for Medium.com, whining about how sexist trolls that comprise the alt-right, including myself, had subjected her to abuse. Now, of course, as I point out in the article, the sum of my abuse was a YouTube video in which I pointed out that having genital warts because you're a slut in her own words, that's not an accomplishment. So she complains that as a result of my video, she received hundreds of messages from people calling her, quote, insert the sexist slur of your choice here. And she cites one example, gives a screenshot of it, of a Twitter user who called her a, quote, whore. Now, let's just recap here. The woman herself says that she's a slut and she's proud of it, then has the temerity to complain about other people calling her a whore and then say that it's this huge harassment campaign against her, when she herself has just said that she's a slut. She celebrates the fact that she's a slut. She celebrates herpes, genital warts, and chlamydia, and then acts all amazed that she would get any kind of blowback out of that. Again, it's not just the fact that, you know, I don't care what you do with your body. If you want to be a slut, go ahead. It's not a very good lifestyle choice. But that's what it is, a lifestyle choice. It's not a form of activism. It's not something to be proud of. There's a stigma around sexually transmitted diseases for a reason, because we have to discourage some forms of behavior that aren't beneficial, that have negative impacts. That's called common sense. Herpes, which she thinks is so brilliant and empowering, it's the new feminist cause to get herpes, can damage the central nervous system, and it can lead to Alzheimer's disease. Apparently, Alzheimer's disease is all the rage now amongst the social justice warriors. It's so trendy to damage your own central nervous system and embrace this new social justice cause of catching STDs, and then having the temerity to shout down anyone, to claim that anyone who voices criticism against that bizarre, absurd opinion is a sexist troll, is harassing you. So this story, she cites my video in the article and whines about how she got hundreds of messages from people, God forbid, disagreeing with her that catching herpes was something to be proud of. But it gets worse. Hillary Clinton sent this woman an official letter. You can see it in the article with the Hillary Rodham Clinton name right at the top, signed at the bottom, official Hillary forward, which looks like, of course, Hillary for hospital logo at the bottom, praising her because she got all this terrible abuse from people who called her a whore for her saying that being a slut was something to be proud of. She called herself a slut and then got butthurt about the fact that other people called her a whore, said it was abuse and harassment. And Hillary Clinton vehemently agrees that she is proud, she is courageous, she's a victim. This is from the letter. From Hillary Clinton to a woman who started a campaign saying that being a slut is something to be encouraged. Quote, I am so grateful to you for not only speaking out against the stigma, but also for taking a courageous stand against the ridiculous but very real barrage of hate you received online. So according to Hillary Clinton, there shouldn't be a stigma around contracting herpes and genital warts. Women, feminists like Ella Dawson should be proud of it, should voice the fact that they're embracing it, and should encourage other young women to embrace sexually transmitted diseases. This is what Hillary Clinton stands for. You're going to have a woman in the White House who thinks that STDs should be celebrated and that that is a form of activism. Again, this is not The Onion. This is a real story. Hillary Clinton thinks that STDs shouldn't be stigmatized. Well, in the real world, some things are stigmatized because discouraging them is the right thing to do. Being a slut isn't something to be proud of. Again, if that's what you want to be and you're not hurting anyone else, then go for it. But it's a terrible lifestyle choice. And then she makes the point or the argument, Ella Dawson, this feminist, that, you know, having herpes, having chlamydia, having sexually transmitted diseases,
there shouldn't be a stigma attached to it because it's just like having diabetes. Little difference there in the fact that diabetes is not contagious. You're going to infect other people against their will in most cases, unless they're as sick as she is. So again, Hillary Clinton embracing somebody who says that being a slut is a positive thing should be embraced along with the genital warts, the herpes, the chlamydia. And of course, the conclusion is that Dawson wrote an article, a follow-up, praising Hillary for her bizarre, widely panned, disastrous alt-right speech. Because again, she called out those disgraceful abusers who harassed her by daring to disagree with the premise that having, you know, pus-filled lesions all over your sexual organs and face was something to be proud of, was trendy, was a new social justice cause. Hillary Clinton writes a letter praising that woman. Absolutely insane. We'll be back on the Alex Jones Show Live in the next segment. Again, huge news coming up about media hoaxes. Breaking news is all at Infowars.com. We'll be back. We are back live on the Alex Jones Show. Now, I mentioned it in the previous segment. Absolutely huge new evidence of media hoaxes. The media openly acting not only as a mouthpiece, but a surrogate of the Clinton campaign. Now, of course, we had Hillary's now infamous collapse on Sunday in New York. The Clinton campaign reacted to that by creating a set of talking points, specifically certain phrases called their daily message guidance, basically ordering all the Clinton staffers, all the surrogates, to go out in the media and to use these phrases over and over again. One of them was that Hillary was going to, quote, power through her health concerns. They claimed she's so vigorous, she's so strong, that even with the pneumonia, she powered through it. Even though, you know, she basically completely collapsed. Her legs couldn't even support her weight. We all saw what happened. But they went out into the media with this narrative, with these talking points, with these exact phrases. Now, you would expect them to do that. But you would also expect them to be called out by the hosts when they make those phrases and try to back them up. But that's not the worst of this. The worst aspect of this is that when these Clinton staffers, when these Clinton surrogates got on MSNBC, got on CNN, and came out with this phrase that Hillary was powering through her health concerns to meet her obligations, the hosts of the show on CNN, on MSNBC, then adopted those same phrases and began themselves regurgitating them. Let's go to the clip.
She made a determination with her doctor that she would power through this. She made a decision to just power through this. We've decided to power through sometimes, just power through this. Continue to power through. Yes, she tried to power through it. She decided to power through it.
Well, you know, Brooke, she just wanted to power through. She just wanted to power through her schedule. So she wanted to just power through and keep doing it.
I appreciate all of her desire to power through.
To power through and get things done. If she tried to power through it.
It was Hillary Clinton's decision, essentially, to power through.
The candidate who famously wants to power through these things, she's going to try and power through.
We say, when you get a cold, just power through, power through.
They thought she could power through. They thought she could power through it. They thought that she could power through it.
Wants to power through things. That too, that the powering through.
Governor Jennifer Granholm said women just power through these things, and I get it. I try to power through all my illnesses.
Hillary Clinton had a very busy day on Friday, and she powered through that day.
Yet she powered through.
Powering through illness is what women do every day.
She continued powering through.
I think about mothers powering through.
I mean, she powered through that week. I'm going to power through. That was her way.
And just did that clip at the end, for those watching on the video stream, look like she was powering through. Now, again, let's emphasize the point about that video. It began with Clinton staffers and Clinton surrogates using those phrases as they had been instructed to do by the Clinton campaign. This is out of Politico. Quote, those phrases, projecting strength, prudence, and vigor, were among the six bullet-pointed talking points about Clinton's health the campaign distributed to its army of outside surrogates Tuesday morning. The marching orders, part of the, quote, daily message guidance from Brooklyn headquarters, instructed Clinton allies on how to answer questions about the Democratic nominee's pneumonia and about how she dealt with the untimely setback. So again, you would expect them to regurgitate those phrases, the Clinton staffers, the Clinton surrogates. But as you saw from that clip, which was put together by the Washington Beacon, not only did those statements, those, you know, stock talking points, those stock phrases, power through, go unchallenged by the hosts on MSNBC, on CNN, they then adopted them for themselves and began using the same term in their own subsequent shows, that Hillary was powering through. So again, absolutely brazen evidence of media hoaxing, brazen evidence of the fact that CNN and MSNBC were not only allowing those Clinton staffers to come on air and spout those talking points, spout that narrative, spout those phrases unchallenged, they themselves adopted the phrases and regurgitated them. Absolute brazen evidence of the fact that the media is controlled in the United States. We know they've said openly, look, we're dispensing with all objectivism to try and sink Donald Trump. They pretend to be neutral. Now they're not even pretending. Now they're openly spouting slogans handed directly to them by Hillary Clinton's campaign. We'll be back with more evidence of media hoaxing on the Alex Jones Show Live. Stay tuned. We're back live on the Alex Jones Show. Before we get back to the news and more huge evidence of media hoaxes, we've got an extended special at InfoWarsStore.com. 30 to 40% off InfoWars select storable food. Due to listener demand, we've extended this, a massive 30 to 40% discount on our InfoWars select storable food at InfoWarsStore.com. Now is the time to stock up on super high quality storable food for you and your family that you can trust. Given that Hillary Clinton has openly threatened war with Russia and basically said that it's likely to happen if she gets into office, probably a good idea to stock up on that storable food right now. And the level of this discount, I mean, personally, I've looked at buying larger quantities of storable food in Europe. The prices are absolutely ridiculous. You're talking $4 to $5 for a small packet of dried food. I mean, nobody can afford it at those prices. This, you get the excellent discount on top of the already extremely reasonable price. I mean, you compare these prices in the US to what's available in terms of storable food in Europe. Again, no competition. It has a shelf life of 25 years. It's made in the USA. The government is stocking up on food. The elite are stocking up on food in their hideaways in New Zealand and places like that. And it's extremely affordable. And again, if nothing happens, if there's no food emergency, then you just eat the food and you save money anyway because of these amazing discounts that we've got at InfoWarsStore.com, on top of the fact that it's extremely affordable to begin with compared with buying it anywhere else in the world. So that's 30 to 40% off special on InfoWars Select storable food at InfoWarsStore.com. Again, there's a reason that FEMA reports predict up to a 395% increase in food prices that could trigger mass unrest. Now, we've got those prices at 30 to 40% off all InfoWars Select storable food, and that's available right now at InfoWarsStore.com. And, of course, it supports the growth of this broadcast to take on the likes of MSNBC and CNN that attack us now on an almost daily basis. So that's why it's so important to support us right now at this critical time by taking advantage of that storable food special at InfoWarsStore.com. Now back to media hoaxes. So we've got CNN, MSNBC openly taking delivery of Hillary Clinton's, quote, daily message guidance and regurgitating the exact phrases powering through, that Clinton surrogates, that Clinton staffers were sent out there to regurgitate themselves. Now it's just out in the open. They've openly embraced their roles as surrogates of the Clinton campaign, delivering those same talking points that were delivered to them. Here's yet another example. Bill Clinton went on CBS with Charlie Rose and basically slipped up, had a Freudian slip, and said that Hillary Clinton frequently collapsed. Now, the problem is they edited it out of the final interview. Thankfully, the transcript was up on the CBS website. People found it and noted that this key phrase had been excised out of what Bill Clinton said. We have the original clip. This is what was not heard when the interview was actually broadcast on CBS News. So let's play the original clip.
When you look at that collapse, that video that was taken, you wonder if it's not more serious.
No,
than dehydration.
If it is, it's a mystery to me and all of her doctors, because rarely, but on more than one occasion over the last many, many years, the same sort of things happened to her when she just got severely dehydrated.
So again, that's Bill Clinton on CBS News. That was the original clip. That was what didn't air when the final broadcast went out. He said, saying Hillary has, quote, rarely, similar medical episodes in the past. So they edited out where he said frequently. Now, of course, Hillary Clinton went on Anderson Cooper, CNN, last night. He asked her, you know, how often she'd had these episodes. She couldn't even remember. I mean, if you faint a limited number of times, you're going to remember it. I've fainted once in my life, and for damn sure I remember it, and I remember how many times it happened, because it's not a pleasant experience. You only wouldn't remember how many times you fainted if it happens all the time, which evidently with Hillary Clinton it does. And Bill Clinton knows that for a fact, and he said it during the interview in that Freudian slip. But of course, the American people can't be trusted with that knowledge. So it was edited out of the final broadcast by CBS News. Absolutely brazen evidence, yet again, of more media censorship. Now, we're going to get back to Bill Clinton in a second. But this is up on Infowars.com. CNN, 10 million Americans get pneumonia every week. Subheadline, no, they don't. This was a CNN guest, Hillary Rosen, a rampant Clinton apologist, again a surrogate, who went on CNN and said that Clinton's illness isn't a big deal because every week in America, 10 million people come down with pneumonia. This is the quote. She was asked, are you worried at all that her being away for a day, 2 days, 3 days, we don't know totally yet, could hurt her politically, asked host Brooke Baldwin. The response from Rosen, quote, look, 10 million Americans a week catch pneumonia. I don't think people begrudge her a couple of days rest. Of course, the problem with that is if 10 million Americans a week are getting pneumonia, there are 52 weeks in a year, that's 520 million Americans who catch pneumonia every year. And that's nearly 200 million more Americans than there are Americans. The population of America is 350 million. It's impossible for 520 million Americans to catch pneumonia every single year. But again, remember CNN a few days ago? You had the reporter on there saying the Hillary aides were smashing cell phones with hammers. The host immediately stopped him in his tracks and said, wait, we have to fact check that. That doesn't sound right. We got to fact check that. So they fact checked that. Turned out to be completely accurate. This completely asinine statement was never fact checked, because of course it would have made her look extremely embarrassed, and it's completely untrue. But notice the new narrative is to try and make it look as if pneumonia is just completely common, that everybody catches pneumonia. Well, I mean, what's the big deal for a 69-year-old woman who's already seriously ill to have pneumonia? I mean, everybody gets it, right? 520 million Americans a year get pneumonia, even though there are only 350 million people in America. But let's not even challenge that. But notice, they're trying to equate pneumonia with the flu to try and make it look extremely common, to try and downplay the fact that this is a major issue when it comes to Hillary Clinton's health. Again, this wasn't challenged, this wasn't fact-checked. Then we go to this clip, which just went up today, actually. It was Bill Clinton giving a speech today in which Bill Clinton said that Hillary Clinton didn't have pneumonia, that she had the flu. Let's go to this clip.
Look, I'm glad to have a chance to stand in for Hillary today. She did it for me for a long time. It's about time I showed up and did it for her. But I just talked to her. She's feeling great. I think she'll be back out there tomorrow. It's a crazy time we live in, you know, when people think there's something unusual about getting the flu. Last time I checked, millions of people were getting it every year. But I thank you.
So again, Bill Clinton got up in a speech today and said that Hillary Clinton has the flu. And, you know, what's the big deal? What's unusual about that? Millions of people get the flu every year. Well, it's not the flu. Even if you believe the pneumonia explanation, that's what her campaign said. They didn't say she had the flu. They said she was treated for pneumonia, which, of course, is a damn sight more critical, more potentially damaging than the flu. So notice how they're mixing it in now with the flu to try and claim that it's a completely common occurrence. Why are we even studying this issue? Why are we even concerned about it if she's just got the flu? I mean, everybody gets the flu, right? Since when did she just have the flu? They said it was pneumonia. Now you've got CNN saying, you know, 10 million people come down with pneumonia a week. Again, trying to equate it with the common occurrence of the flu. Now you've got Bill Clinton, who himself is obviously extremely ill, has been for a while, falls asleep at the height of the DNC when Hillary's giving her speech. You know, he's had heart surgery. Up there, again, they've told so many lies, they're just confused now. Or is it just confusion, or is it genuinely trying to equate the flu with pneumonia to try and dismiss it as no big deal? Here's another article out of the American Mirror on a similar subject. Campaign acknowledges Hillary still hasn't recovered from Sunday collapse. Hillary Clinton's campaign sent an email to supporters on Wednesday acknowledging she hasn't yet recovered from her collapse on a New York City street on Sunday, but that she's on her way to 100%. So again, they say she hasn't recovered 4 days later, yet within 90 minutes, the Clinton campaign came out with a statement before the now infamous video hit the internet saying that she was, quote, feeling great. And all the mainstream media outlets regurgitated that talking point completely unchallenged. CNN did it. I made a video about it on Sunday, saying that within 90 minutes of this supposed overheating and dehydration, which is how they initially tried to spin it before the video came out and before we all saw what happened, within 90 minutes, they said she was feeling great. She was out on the street hugging a child, even though she had pneumonia. Let's not ask any questions about that. But again, within 90 minutes, the campaign, the media, said she was feeling great. Yet still, now 4 days later, they admit she hasn't fully recovered from the collapse. So which is it? Again, caught in another brazen lie. How many do we need to see? But of course, the mainstream media says, and this is the headline up on Infowars.com, you're sexist if you question Hillary's health. Because it's not like the mainstream media obsessed about John McCain's health ad infinitum all throughout the 2008 presidential campaign, is it? We had Kirsten Powers on CNN trying to trot out this narrative. Now Kathleen Parker, writing for the Washington Post, assailed other media outlets for asking if Hillary Clinton can physically handle the rigors of being president following her medical episode on Sunday. So again, just forget about the video, forget about the pneumonia, forget about the blood clots. It's sexist to even ask the question. Despite the fact, as the Daily Mail reports, the first Clinton health cover-up revealed, doctor tells how Hillary kept blood clots secret from her staff and had nurse travel with her in plain clothes to administer drugs. Isn't that interesting, given our story yesterday about the neurological test that Hillary Clinton was seen receiving before her collapse? The article states Hillary Clinton allowed her staff to mistakenly think that she had pulled a muscle rather than tell them she had a blood clot in 1998. So it goes back that far. The Democratic presidential candidate, who was first lady at the time, did not correct White House staffers when they assumed the problem with her right leg was due to over-exercising. So she's been lying about her health since at least 2008, 18 years ago. The Week reports half the country thinks Clinton has lied about her health to the public. 50% of Americans think that Hillary Clinton has lied about her health, and this poll also finds that 30%, almost 3 in 10 Americans, think she will die before 2020. So 30% of Americans now think that Hillary Clinton won't even make it through her first term as president. Now, to me, these numbers of 50% thinking she's lied about her health seem quite low. I mean, this poll was conducted September 12th, September 13th, so it was after the infamous collapse. Maybe it was before the mainstream media actually started to grow a pair and actually call her out on it and say that even they'd been deceived. But again, 50% of Americans distrust Hillary Clinton on her health. Almost 3 in 10 think she won't even make it through her first term. Breitbart reports doctors raise concerns over Clinton's pneumonia diagnosis and treatment. Doctors are raising concerns about Hillary Clinton's recent pneumonia diagnosis and treatment, suggesting a case of the disease that causes a patient to collapse should be treated more seriously. Executive Director of the Association of American Physicians and Surgeons, Dr. Jane Orient, another conspiracy theorist, who previously said Clinton's coughing fit appeared more serious than allergies, spoke to Breitbart News during a phone interview on Monday. She said, quote, "Most people with pneumonia are sick in bed and they have a fever, and it's very hard for them to be up and about." Orient, who identifies as a Republican, again, massive conspiracy theorist, explained during the interview, "I would have advised her to cancel the event." Obviously, she didn't get the memo that Hillary Clinton was powering through. She failed to regurgitate that talking point. So again, the questions continue to swirl about Hillary Clinton. The cover-ups have become so convoluted that people like Bill Clinton, her own staffers, can't even keep up with the narrative. They keep contradicting themselves. Let's switch to global news now. Austrian cardinal tipped to be the next pope warns of an Islamic conquest of Europe. An Austrian cardinal who's one of the frontrunners to be the next pope has warned of an Islamic conquest of Europe. According to reports of his speech to mark the 333rd anniversary of the Battle of Vienna, of course, that evil, horrible crusade war that was actually a defensive war to save Christianity and Western civilization, Cardinal Christoph Schönborn said, quote, "Will there be an Islamic conquest of Europe? Many Muslims want that and say Europe is at its end." He's obviously a racist. The clips of top imams in Jerusalem saying that that's precisely what they want through the migrant crisis. They don't exist. Another racist has been exposed. Daily Mail. "Who the F are all you racists? Violent Turkish migrants film themselves beating up a cyclist, dancing on police officers and intimidating others." They go, they harass women, they throw stones at people, they attack cyclists, they laugh about it, they say, "We don't need to get a job, we're going to stay here, we're Erdogan's army." And the Socialist Party leader came out and said they were just unpolished diamonds. That's your cultural enrichment. We'll be right back on The Alex Jones Show Live. Stay tuned. Final segment of The Alex Jones Show. And again, before we hit a few final news stories, I want to remind you about that special 30 to 40% off InfoWars Select storable food at InfoWarsStore.com. Massive discount. We've also got Super Male Vitality, 20% off for a limited time at InfoWarsLife.com while supplies last. Again, you can read the 5-star reviews, see how it's helped other listeners transform their bodies with super male vitality. And again, 30 to 40% off our special on InfoWars Select storable food at InfoWarsStore.com. It goes directly to build the broadcast to help us take on the mainstream media. Because unlike Black Lives Matter, we're not funded to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars a year by George Soros. Unlike CNN, we're not funded by giant pharmaceutical companies. We're funded by you, the listener, buying the products at InfoWarsStore.com and InfoWarsLife.com. Let's hit a few final news stories. This is out of the National Post of Canada. Feminist Trudeau under attack for attending gender-segregated event at Ottawa Mosque. Canada's self-styled feminist prime minister, Mr. It's the Current Year, was praised Tuesday by one of the world's most powerful women for his commitment to gender equality, even as he was taking it on the chin from other women for appearing at a gender-segregated event the previous day. So, of course, he went to a mosque, and the proud feminist Justin Trudeau stood there at this gender-segregated event. Again, why is Trudeau validating gender segregation if he's a proud feminist? You can only pick one, Justin. It's women's rights or it's Islam. You can't have both. Another story out of Information Liberation. Germany, far-left MP smuggles in African refugee in his trunk, brags about it on Facebook. A far-left extremist politician in Germany smuggled in an African refugee into Germany, again, completely illegal, in the trunk of his car, then bragged about it on Facebook. No surprise, given that, you know, the head of the Green Party gets up in front of the German parliament and says that Germans will be a minority in their own cities within 20 years, and that that's a good thing. You know, Antifa openly calling for white people to be killed. They're racist. They hate their own country. And again, yet another example of that. Meanwhile, over in London, London's first Muslim mayor has appointed a deputy integration mayor who has worked with CAGE, an extremist organization who described Islamic State executioner Jihadi John as a beautiful man. Well, imagine my shock. This is the guy who shared a platform with an ISIS supporter 9 times before he was elected. This is a guy who says that moderate Muslims are, quote, Uncle Toms. Now he's appointing people as integration ministers who openly worked for extremist organizations that praised people who chopped heads off. That's our new mayor in Londonistan. Isn't it wonderful, the cultural enrichment that we're now enjoying? Let's get to a couple of final stories here. We've got one out of CNN. Political prediction market. Clinton odds for White House drop 14 points. Democratic presidential nominee Hillary Clinton's odds of winning the White House have dropped 14 points since Friday. Of course, we had the basket of deplorables comment. She's dropped from 72%. Again, these odds are sometimes more accurate than the actual polls. We know people are sometimes reticent to answer truthfully in the polls. Ever since the basket of deplorables, ever since the collapse, Hillary Clinton is losing steam fast. Trump is also up in Ohio. That's going to wrap it up, though. Nightly news coming up. Alex Jones will be back tomorrow, breaking news at InfoWars.com.